What is going on, everybody? I am Antonius the Gamer. Welcome to another episode of the Gamer Podcast. I'm once again joined by my co-hosts, Super SSS Rank and Mikkel Smith. Fellas, thank you guys for joining me for another episode. I want to give a quick disclaimer to all of our listeners and viewers. I am a little under the weather and have been for the past couple of weeks. So if I sound a little off, if there's a couple of pauses, or if I'm not as vocal this part around, I'm trying to just focus on my health. But, you know, we push through and we move. Fellas, we got a lot of topics that we got to get through today. But, of course, you know, also want to check in publicly how y'all feeling. How is everyone doing on their end?
Good, good. Just holding on, man. Holding on. Mm. This Elden Ring life is eating up. Mm-hmm. Right now I'm in Caleb.
Life is in an interesting state of transition, so I'm just trying to stay focused and push through.
Amen to that. It's this whole new year, new start don't seem to translate as much as when you get older. It's just like it's the continuing balance, right? The tab continues to build as you get older. I'm like, oh, none of these things went anywhere because it's a new year. All right, that's what's up. I guess I'll keep trying to figure it out. But with no further delay, we have a lot of topics to get into, and we'll get right to it. We'll get right into one of the main topics of our group chat this past week, which has been the release of Tekken 8. Tekken 8 is now on your console, now on your digital storefront, now in your physical stores. It's been getting 8 out of 10s, 9 out of 10s, 9.5 out of 10s. It's being heralded as probably the greatest Tekken game since Tekken 3, if not the greatest Tekken game out, period.
Tekken 5 was amazing.
I'm just telling what people have been saying. The streets are talking about. And, you know, we've spoken at length about this game along the way, about how it looked, how it was looking compared to its competitors, and now how it's looking in the final stretch. And now that it's out, fellas, what did we think? How do you feel about how Tekken 8 came out as a final product? How it's been received from what you guys have seen before we get into the details about the story? Just the overall game.
You go first, Jory.
I like it. I love it, man. It's fun. It's alive. It's different, but still the same. It's not like you're just going to hop in and you're going to know everybody's playlist like that. It's not changed too much, but it's changed just enough to keep things interesting with new things pieced on to it. Because this is the largest move list that a Tekken game, in my opinion, has ever had, because there's so much stuff you can do. Mm. And judging from how they treated Tekken 7, this treatment is probably going to get high S-class treatment, because the campaign was the best in a long time. Even though I enjoyed 7, I guess the news reporter guy was throwing a lot of people off. But for the most part of 7, I really enjoyed it, because who asked for Akuma to be in there?
I mean, we did, technically.
We were shocked when it did happen, yeah, right? No, we didn't really know that was going to take place. So that was a crazy trailer. But for what we're getting now, this is a good treat for what we're getting for this for a start to the new year. I'm glad Tekken came out. When it came out and didn't come out anytime before that, its launch roster is very strong. This is 32 characters. What more do you want? 32 characters on this
unheard of in this fighting game era. Unheard of.
And you don't. And then not only that, but there's a second. Once I realized, because I was left wanting more from the story mode, but there's another story mode there, but it's the arcade mode. Mm-hmm. The one that's online, the one that you can do online. But this teaches you how to play Tekken. And what I liked about it, it kind of reminded me of Pokemon or Beyblade or Metabots. You would just go to the arcade and there's a guy, you have a rival, and then you're using this rival. This rival is challenging you, and you're learning how to play the game through that mode. And that mode is actually helping people. I'm seeing people on Twitter like, yo, I finally understand Tekken. I think I could do this game. I'm like, man, this is the greatest success I've seen for someone who wants to make their game more inclusive, for a company to make their game more inclusive. They have all the mechanics there. You can fight your ghost. You can fight a version of you to see where, how stale you fight, to understand, okay, I need to make improvements here, here, and here. This character allows me to do this, this, and this. And it's just so much to learn because now nobody's stuck to one character. Everybody can choose a lot. So this gives the learning curve. It gives you enough to learn, but then so much more to master. Mm. That's how I'm not feeling about Tekken. And I think that's what everybody else likes about it too. Listen, some of your, I think everybody's good in this game. Hmm. I think everybody's good in this game. I'm playing everybody the way it feels. And even some of the, like, they'll have these auto combos. And these auto combos, I can see people, it's being useful to people playing for the first time comers to Tekken. So I think it's I'm still playing it now. It feels great, man. It feels great. It's this. It reminds me of Tekken 5, because to me, Tekken 5, that was that golden era of PlayStation, Xbox, and the GameCube having games that were just like unheard of, mm-hmm. and games that we didn't think we needed, and we just didn't know that we needed, and it came from that era. So that was it's a game that I can't wait to see what happens to it later on. But for right now, if we don't get anything for a while, the game will still be alive and popping because not everybody's attached to one character. Yeah, you see a lot of Ahu Senna mains, but
and a lot of King mains once too. Somebody not picks,
yeah, a lot of King is always going to be King. Mm-hmm. You know, that's I expect that. But the stuff that Lars can do, Raven can do, Victor, the new Mishima, she is amazing. The learning curve is high, but man, the stuff that she could do, the stuff that a lot of people can do, everybody's deadly in this game. Everybody. So that's my take on, that's my time with Tekken.
Okay. Tim, what are your thoughts?
Overall, I'm glad that they took their time. I am just glad that they took their time with it. It feels like a well-balanced package, I would say. Because, you know, sometimes as of lately, especially when it comes to fighters, it's like when that launch windows gets closer and closer, you start to feel like, oh yeah, here's the DLC plan. And it's like, so this couldn't have been part of the game? Mm. With this one, I feel like, you know, there were some interesting roster decisions, I would say. But overall, this Tekken is pretty good, man. It's pretty good. Like, obviously, like, and I'm glad Jory mentioned this, like, you know, that treatment that Tekken 7 got, you know, in the beginning. I didn't buy Tekken 7 in the beginning. I waited till at least the second DLC pack came out to buy it. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a sale, and then I got it for $20, bro. Like, it just felt good, man. It felt very, very good. I just love how, you know, they just kept adding new things like frame data, things for training modes, even just the way how they handle their characters, man. There was one patch where they gave characters new moves.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So mm-hmm. it's like that. You could tell they're adding so much detail to Tekken that you wish that other fighters would take seriously. When I say other fighters, I mean the big three.
Yeah,
I would say as of mm-hmm. currently. You know, the story, I mean, I don't know if you want to get into that right now, but we could.
Not yet.
but overall, man, like, yes, Tekken feels good, man. I'm really looking forward to seeing what this life cycle with this particular game looks like. Mm. It's well worth it. It's very well worth it.
Would you guys say, because this is how I feel, at least, I would say, at least out of the big three, and for those who have never listened to our podcast before, I'm talking about Mortal Kombat, Street Fighter, Tekken. I feel like this might be the strongest vanilla version of a fighting game that we've gotten in the past year. You know, where like you're not seeing certain things like, ooh, where's the day one patch for this? Or, you know, the meta is clearly here, here, and here. Like, you know, like initially with Street Fighter, it's like, for as balanced as it was, everyone was picking Cammy and everyone was picking Ken. And that's all you would see because they just had a bit of an advantage over everybody. Mortal Kombat had literally, if you were player two, you were probably going to lose. That's how bad of a patch it needed for a while. Whereas with Tekken, I mean, granted, I haven't played it myself yet, but just from what I've seen and witnessed and what I'm seeing feedback-wise, I'm like, I'm sure there will be some meta very, very quickly. That's just the nature of any fighter. But it just seems like in terms of like what you said, Tim and them taking their time, it's like we got everything we would probably need to keep a gamer satisfied with a fighting game for quite some time. Like Jory said, the arcade mode is its own story mode. Like we've been cooking Mortal Kombat, especially for not having quality offline content. And Tekken's like, here's this whole other mode for you to play once you've beaten this 4-hour story. You know, not to mention the arcade ladders for all 32 characters with CGI endings. You know what I'm saying? It's like, here's all the reasons why you should give us $70. And it's like, yeah, okay. No complaints. You know, like I wouldn't mind paying full price for a game. Yeah, I feel like I'm getting my money's worth. You know, so like,
I mean, go ahead. No, I mean, look how much fun people are having making these character costumes. I've seen Goku, and it looks Agent Smith, Neo. I'm looking at the character customization, and you get all of that through playing the arcade. Mm-hmm. You get these special costumes. They turn Raven into Scorpion.
That's amazing.
I'm like, man. And that's like, I'm like, yo, they turned Victor into Solid Snake. They had Nina as Tomb Raider. I mean, what are you like? This is why you play a game. Tekken doesn't take itself too seriously, but it's a very serious game, and I think that's the joy of it, giving me Tekken Tag vibes, the humor, you know. People are having a great time, man.
Do you walk back any of your hate for the mascot characters now that you have been able to play the game?
I personally think they take up a slot. Like, I think Kuma and Panda should kind of be stacked behind each other, and you just like swipe whatever color Panda or whatever moveset you want them to have. I think personally, if you're gonna do that, because it just wastes the slot. Like, have another character be there or whatnot, you know? Because Kuma and Panda, yeah, he has some Heihachi. He's not Heihachi, guys. You people thought he was gonna fight just like Heihachi. No, goodness, man.
Could you make the same argument about Devil Jin? Did Devil Jin warrant his own slot, like he has in previous games?
Oh, I never asked for Devil Jin. They should have just had some new character come in, absorb Devil Jin's ability, and then you know now we have another fiasco along. I would have taken that over, you know.
Yeah, because clearly they can do a hybrid moveset like a Kazuya. Kazuya switches between his devil form and his regular form and his combos, and it works just fine. It works just fine.
Yeah, they could do that. Yeah, he burns meter, and that's when he's in that mode, he's ridiculous.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, so clearly y'all figured out a way to make it work. You didn't have to make Devil Jin his own character, especially once you introduce, spoiler alert, Saint Seiya Jin. You know, it's like, did you need to make him his own slot?
That was wild, man. That was wild, man.
Yeah.
That was wild.
I mean, with that, we could probably go into story. I just wanted to talk about everything else leading up to the game. You know, it seems like we're all on the same page about that. Yes, it's definitely very, very much deserving of the praise and accolades it's been getting. And the fact that this is only week one, month one of such a long life cycle of Tekken content that we're sure is coming is refreshing. The only thing, I was going to ask one other thing about the game. All right, it's fine. Well, if it comes back to me, I'll ask. But let's get into the story mode. How do you guys feel about the story? Did you like it? Did you hate it? Indifferent to it?
I gave the story a 7. It was strong, especially like like I said in the chat, second 7 felt more stoic, but then this one felt, and you know, I'm using your terminology here, Anthony, Tekken 8 felt more like an anime. There was a lot of moving parts, and there were just certain story aspects I kind of feel like, well, that's it, like you're not going to elaborate on that. Like, for example, you know, one of the biggest selling points at the starting of the marketing was June's return.
Mm-hmm.
But when you play the story mode, she's there, but not really there. But also there.
Final Fantasy VII.
so it was kind of like, I, cause
giving up already.
Cause personally for me, I've been waiting to know what this love story between her and Kazuya was, because when you really look at what happened in Tekken 7, now I understand the madness of Kazuya, because basically he's never really truly known love except from his grandfather. And you know, his grandfather's dead. You found out that your mother, who's, you know, comes from a rival clan, and she didn't really love you, had a pact with an ancient demon to come destroy you and your father. So it's kind of like, you know, my father hated me because of my mother's genes that passed down to me. So it's kind of like, well, wow, the only love I've ever truly known was Jewel. And you want to know, how did that happen? How did that happen?
Never gets explained. We don't know.
And then
not to mention, go ahead.
And then, yeah, this is my final point. And then the other part was, you know, the new Mishima edition. So, like, you got subtle hints that, you know, because, you know, Harada has even tweeted this, like, yes, Heihachi has, like, almost like 15 to 25 illegitimate children out there, but what makes this one so special? Actually, what made Lars and this one so special? Mm. And you know, Lars finally got his little bro moment with Kazuya, which I appreciated. But it's just, I feel like when it comes to these kids, it's like you're adding so many, but you're not giving us more detail about them.
Yeah.
You know,
it's probably been the best effort they've made so far, though, to be fair.
Yeah, because they dropped the ball with Tekken 6 in terms of, like,
This is, you know, if we're going by like what they've given us before, this is probably the most in-depth that they've gotten, give all things considered. Because we've talked on this podcast before about, like, had it not been for some YouTube videos, I would have had no idea what's going on with certain things in Tekken, with certain characters. And I feel like this did a good job of, like, streamlining a lot of that lore into a very digestible way, where it's like, okay, I can piece together what's happening here for the most part. Mm-hmm. But like you said, Tim, at a surface level. Oh. No, go ahead, Jordan. You good.
I personally felt like they should have went in. The story should have been constructed a little bit more thorough. Like, okay, Jin, you killed Miguel's lady. Where's Miguel? Why is Miguel not a part of this game?
DLC.
Okay, now if we go there, you got to give us a DLC storyline. That's what I'm anticipating.
Yeah. Because
the game ended on a cliffhanger. No, and I'm actually more hopeful that's gonna actually take place, and it's gonna be bundled with Tekken Force. Because there was a lot of the Tekken Force.
I can see it though. Incredible. There was a lot of Tekken Force. Because it felt like a gimmick.
You play,
but it's like five missions.
Yeah, you can't
like Tekken Force, bro.
Yeah, you can't really you can't assume like, oh yeah, this is just a treat. A cameo homage, like, nah, this is they're playing this.
You play Tekken Force with like five different people in the game.
Five different people in the game, and they all have all. Nah, man, that's I don't know why Tim views stuff this way, bro. It's not. I mean, they're showing you everything. Other thing, we thought we weren't gonna get all these people. Now we have them. We constantly say we're not getting Yoshimitsu. Yoshimitsu's DLC. Yoshimitsu's not DLC. Right?
I mean, we were half the right, though. Eddie Gordo is DLC. We did call that. It's like, it's going to be either both or one of the two.
No, but the thing is, but now somebody pointed out, I think, I don't know who said this specifically, but it was like, yeah, why would you make Eddie the main roster? Eddie returning in Tekken 8 would give people more of an incentive. Like, think about the bundle pack. You got Eddie, you got Leu Long, and then you have who else that you have?
Another character who was DLC before.
It's been proven with Mortal Kombat that the audience don't care about as much as we do.
Yeah, the thing is, you know,
they sell us Akuma.
I think
sell us Rain. Every franchise does it.
And we're expecting like this is not going to be the same Lay. This is going to be a different Lay. We, you know, everybody's looking for the glow up. This is one thing the momentum that Tekken has going for.
Well, technically not, because when you look at the story, it's only been 5 months.
Since Tekken 6?
Yeah, no, since Tekken 7. It's only been five.
Since Tekken 7? Yeah,
it's only been 5 months.
So, you know, I'm waiting for Miguel. I think, story-wise, I think Miguel should have been at least hinted, you know, hey, Jin.
Giving how much you focus on Jin. That makes sense.
You know? story mode wise, right? Kazuya should have been doing his own thing, and a reason to find Jin. You know, when I say doing his own thing, like how he had the tournament, because Tim, you didn't play it, man. There was a part in the game where they have an actual tournament, and you pick and choose who you want to play.
I saw that part.
Okay, that was perfect. Now, they should have made it more clear that Kazuya was looking for Zafina, you know, and scouring the earth, and Zafina's trying to hide, and she's losing control over Azazel, because that's who Kazuya wants. Kazuya wants to challenge Azazel, absorb his power, because Kazuya wind up learning that there was more to Azazel's ability, and then therefore, and Zafina, she was going to expose herself and actually use Claudio. Use Claudio the Quincy as the last resort to seal away Azazel and Kazuya, but it backfires, right? And then, you know, there was so much things working for it. Okay, Jin is trying to get there before it shouldn't have been Jin trying to get his mojo back. It should have been Jin was on the verge of being destroyed, and Kazuya found a way to,
at least,
you know,
not for that long.
Do something.
It was for too long.
Not for that long, right? It was for too long. And okay, now Jin is training. Jin finds his mother. His mother reveals more secrets. His mother's actually the one who taught Claudio, and is the reason why, or whatever. They knew each other from long. Something.
She's the Oracle.
The story should have been more intuitive, you know? It would make sense, right? Yeah. You would need that level
given
of power.
Given what happens
to,
towards,
know,
the end, like, it actually would make a lot of sense.
You know? The reason why Heihachi had all these illegitimate children is because he wanted to make sure he was not responsible for the Devil Gene. And so he had Lars Alexander, and Lars Alexander was his most promising weapon to fight and combat the Devil Gene without the Devil Gene, you know? Mm-hmm. And so now all these 12 legitimate children, he couldn't tally it. He's dead now. So now certain things are taking place that, you know, maybe Kazuya found out, hey, these guys are threatening me. Let me go around the world and try to kill these guys one by one. And Kazuya's being successful. He's killing members of his own family. You know, the story could have been, it is a story there. You just got to think, man. So I don't know if they were pressed for time. I don't know their thinking process and how they approach stories. But I'm like, you guys have all the tools you need to make a great story. And even for what it was, right? It's not a perfect story. Mm-hmm. I think the way to introduce Reyna acting like she's aloof and, oh, yeah, you know, I'm just, Jin, I love you so much. You're so cool. And then secretly, like, oh, man, he just don't know. I'm going to destroy you, bro. I'm going to take everything from you, Jin. Yeah, I'm just using you for Kazuya, but I'm going to murder you because secretly I'm crazy. And I have to, you know what I'm saying? Stuff like that. Miguel should have been, yeah, go ahead.
There actually was a theory that I saw, because you remember at the beginning of the game where they showed the mural and it was like Azazel.
Yeah.
Two henchmen on the side. So people were spectating that one side was the Kazuya's mother's clan on one side, her clan, the Hachigo clan. And some people are thinking there's another clan out there which Reyna belongs to. So people are thinking that Reyna is another child of, child of Heihachi, but he made it with another person who carries the Devil Gene. Because you remember, like, you could tell she knew she had it, but she was trying to figure out how to unlock it, because that's why she kept studying Gene. And Kazuya, like, oh, so it's unlocked from desire. Oh, but it, you know, but also, like, you know, like Super Saiyan, it comes out during the most tragic moment, like, basically near death. So that's why, like, she was like, hit me in the trailer. Mm-hmm.
See? And that's...
So now, because the thing about it is, she never revealed her last name. And remember, Tekken is big on names, like...
Eddie Gordo.
Big on names. Big on...
Paul Phoenix. Like,
Martial law.
Yeah.
Oh, Reyna.
Bruce Irving.
Reyna what?
Yeah.
The only person that don't matter is Fuck Robin, because that's just Fuck Robin. That's it.
You feel me? All right, I'll give my thoughts. I'll give my thoughts. I do think also it was a 7 out of 10. I think it was. I want to say it was like it's a 15 chapter story. Chapters 1 through 11 are fairly solid. I think a lot of things that you said, Joyo, were good points. There's a couple little tweaks you could have made along the way to make it even more of a standout story. But again, the bones of what was there was good. This was a good, solid approach to having how do I involve 30 plus characters into this narrative. You know, Tim took my summary, but it's true. It felt like the Tekken team was watching a lot of anime during the development cycle. Like it was just references on references on references. Like you talk about Hollow Ichigo and
him. It helped losing. Him. It helps stuff make sense though.
It helps stuff make sense.
Utilizing Claudio to that, I think they should have kept that momentum of utilizing characters, but continue.
Right, but that's the thing. Is like they study these elements of anime that do work, right? There are monumental moments from their respective shows, but they did it without... It was like surface level. Like there was not enough underneath for it to matter. Like when Claudio does his whole, I need some time to prepare, I'm like, bro, I don't care what you do, honestly. You know, like you're not that important. Even when Kazuya makes the plan to absorb Azazel, like this kind of feels like convenience. Like, oh, how convenient that his plan gets revealed because she just happens to show up. As opposed to what you said, Jory, of like, I'm looking for her. I'm making mention of doing something to draw her out so I can come find her and get Azazel. It's just like, oh, good thing she showed up. It's like, oh, I had no idea you planned to get her in the first place, Kazuya. Cool. You know, or the fact that, like, how strong is Reyna really? Because initially she is able to like fight Kazuya off with no Devil Trigger, you know, like with no Devil Gene of her own.
She is strong.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
and she fought the super version.
Yeah, and was able to hold him off by herself. You know what I'm saying? So there's certain things. Like, it's just like, you know, and then later on in the game, you have Lars doing the same thing. And Lars is going 8 gates of death against Sage Madara just to buy Jin a couple more minutes. So I'm like, so how strong is she? Because this man doing lightning style Chidori all over the jungle trying to hold Kazuya off.
you know what made the fight between Kazuya and Jin enjoyable, especially when Jin turns Angel Jin? That was the most enjoyable quick time event I've ever had. I wish there's things you can take from Cyber Connect too, you know? The part where he was doing the beams and you had to press up, down, side, that was a challenging quick time event. They should have had something to where Claudio, listen, don't miss, otherwise Kazuya's gonna have 2 life bars. You know? Mm-hmm. And they would have made these things more, because I don't feel a story mode has to entirely mimic how are you going to play online? We know
which it
that
didn't.
There's
a difference. To their credit, it
and
didn't.
And it did it. And that's great. Yeah. I wish I saw more of that momentum and throughout the game. Like the fight with Lars, that could have been, you know, listen, you need Lars to do as much damage because if you don't, Jin has half a life bar.
Mm.
And, you know, these things make the, oh my God, because you want people to be attached to certain moments. The reason why a lot of people love Tekken 7 story mode was the fact that when it came time, when I was fighting, everybody remembers Akuma.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody remembers Akuma versus Heihachi. These are iconic fights, staple fights, fights that matter, fights that have weight to them. With Lars, They could have slowly built up Lars's desire to actually, oh, listen, I have to stop Kazuya because now Jin's out of commission. So
it was still good.
Who's gonna stop these?
It was still good.
It was good. It was good. It was great. But you know, there's so much story they could have told, man. They could have focused on the illegitimate children and Kazuya going out and say, listen, you guys have something I need. And he's going after them. He sends Nina to go locate the rest because he can't be everywhere at once. Mm-hmm. He's now these guys have usefulness. I see why. Now it makes sense. Now you have Raven, right? You have the creator of the Raven. He's exposing himself now. But no Master Raven? No mention of Master Raven? I said Master Raven's on a I hope, because that's the rawest black lady you had. Rawest black lady next to Kimberly now. Mm. In a fighting game. Like, that virtual fighter lady, she could sit over there. Nobody looked better than Master Raven. I'm sorry. Master Raven made me draw for 4 weeks straight. Because I was like, man, this is great character design. That's a part of the reason why I love Tekken over a lot of fighting games, because their character design is so alluring.
Yeah.
And it's not, it's modern, but at the same time, it's still unique to Tekken.
No, it's stylized, right? Because you look at
it's Devil super Jin, stylized. It's like, you get what I'm saying?
Why is Devil Jin dressed like Yugi? Like, why? What is Japan's like obsession with like belt straps or in places that they don't belong? Like, I don't understand. Like, why does this show that you're emo in Japan? Someone please explain this to me.
Yeah, but you know, that would have been a crazy storyline. Not to mention Steve Fox has something to do, because he's not born normally. Like, where does that, you know, let's go on. You have elements to pull from. Why is Dragunov so hated by the Raven organization? Why is Dragunov so, you know?
But that all,
Brian Fury.
All the things that you're saying, though, is that, remember, I've had this discussion with you guys months and months ago on the pod. I said, one of the things that I don't like Tekken about is that it focuses too much on one family. When you have all these other interesting characters that can also push the plot forward. At a certain point, no, like, I'm tired of, you know what I'm saying? Like, and this game, going back to the story, like, drives it home, especially once you get to chapters 12 through 15, where you're fighting Kazuya 45 times in a row. I don't want to see this family fight anymore. I don't care. It's been, like you said, those moments now at this point have been given to me. I've seen Hayachi and Kazuya.
I've seen Hayachi
and Kazuya fight in a volcano. I've seen Jin and Kazuya fight on a meteor heading back to Earth as an angel and a demon. Okay. Enough.
Okay. That fight.
Enough.
I have some. Tim made a very good point on certain things. The fight didn't feel as satisfying, and it didn't have as much weight.
Now, it borrows from the best parts and the worst parts of Naruto.
Two things, right? Two things I would have. Location needed to change for Kazuya and Jin.
No, it did. Location had to change. It did.
No. It did and it didn't. Because
it did.
I'm still fighting on a volcano.
Because it's three chapters of fighting. That's why. It did. Right, you fight in the jungle, you're fighting in the air through quick time events, you land on the meteor, right? Or the meteor shoots yourself up to the heavens. It's not their fault that the fight then takes another two chapters of them falling back to Earth, and then they fight in the remains of the meteor on the ground when it starts raining. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not gonna knock them. But
The meteor that
or anything for that matter. It just landed perfectly back.
Well,
in the same
place. Well, that island was the same size as the island of Española. So I think the planet would have been okay.
Yeah.
Oh,
that was my thing. Like, it's been my one big glaring thing that I keep coming back to with Tekken over and over. It'd be like with Street Fighter. If every single story revolved around Ryu and the Dark Hado, and Akuma had to show up at the end of every game, I'd be sick of it. If Liu Kang and Shang Tsung had to clash at the end of every single game, I would be sick of it. And I don't care how well designed this family is.
Killed my brother.
I understand.
What you mean?
No, I understand. And that's the thing. Tekken has cruised on the laurels to some degree of just how cool these characters are. Right? I'm like, Jin is a coolly designed character. Kazuya, cool designed character. Even Reyna, cool designed character. I don't care about this family no more. I don't. They've impacted the story long enough now. Like, please, let something else happen. Like you said, why is Dragunov hated so much? Why are all these characters doing that? Like, since when did Paul embrace this like sumo lifestyle of like my fist is my power? When did that happen? Off screen, like everything else, because nobody else matters. The biggest issue I had when the story was when Kazuya shows up and like carpet bombs the entire battlefield. So I'm like, so everyone's dead? Because we never go back to them ever again at the end of the story mode. He shows up, wipes out both sides, and flies off. I'm just like, so everyone's dead. They're all dead, right? No one else got back up besides Reyna.
No.
No, I know they're not dead, but it's like, so everyone's dead because you never, ever, ever cut back to the rest of the story.
All those G soldiers are dead. Paul and Lars and all them boys, they kicking.
Oh, conveniently survived off screen.
Conveniently survived off screen, yeah. You know, Paul is opening a restaurant with his boy. Feng Wei and Bruce Leroy beef. That was a story to be told, but nothing there. And Feng Wei is actually, you know, and did you guys know that the God Fist came from Feng Wei's clan?
I did, but because of YouTube.
Yeah,
not because of the game.
Now, in terms of what you said, in terms of story, Anthony, I think that's where they're going to utilize Tekken Bloodline to fill in the gaps. My only thing about it is, you know, if you're going to use Tekken Bloodline in this way, which I do feel like it's productive, and, you know, it also brings multiple streams back to the series, when these next games come out, you got to reread the source material, man, because why does it feel like this was the first time that he met Bruce Leroy? Oh, Leroy Smith, I mean, why does it feel like that was the first time him and Jim met each other? Like, no, bro, you cracked his leg, and that's why he has a cane. Why did that have to be retconned? And then, you know, to go back on, like, other character beefs, you know, a prime example would be Yoshimitsu versus Brian Fury. Because Brian Fury killed members of his clan, betrayed him. So that's why he's on the hunt to destroy him. And then, you know, as you also see, Yoshimitsu has a cursed sword, which has a very interesting connection.
In terms of what?
Like, okay, now my thing is, if it's a new Yoshimitsu all the time, then that beef can't be relevant.
No, because see, the thing about it is they have made it clear that the Soul Calibur Yoshimitsu is an ancestor to this current one. Yeah, so basically, like, the term, the name Yoshimitsu is like a title, basically like Kenpachi. It's a title.
I can get behind that. But yeah, that's my issue, bro. It was a good story. Beautiful graphics, right? I'm like, it's probably the most competitive, I'd say, in terms of Mortal Kombat, in terms of cinematic storytelling, right? The scale of what's happening was amazing. Mm-hmm. Love the homage to Tekken Force. Love the, even though it was like a lazy Easter egg, you know, the whole Master Raven, the whole Raven saying Hayachi Mishima is dead. It's like, it's cool. You know, like, those type of things are cool.
That was funny in the chat, man.
Yeah, it's like those type of things, those like little nods are cool. Say, you know, but it's just like,
Hayachi Mishima
is at dead. A certain point, it's like, my whole takeaway was when Jin went Golden Jin, Angel Jin, Kurama mode, linked Jin with all Nine Tails powers, and cut through Bahamut Blast and did everything that we've seen in every anime from our upbringing. I'm like, this is enough. Let's not do this ever again in a Tekken story mode.
The power of friends.
My friends are my power, Jin. I don't need to see this happen ever again. Let this be it. Please.
Unfortunately, you know, you get rid of one fallen angel, one devil, and you get another devil back. So Reyna has unlocked her devil
gene. They don't have it no more.
And I really do hope that they do give a story DLC, because I refuse to wait till Tekken 9 to find out.
I'm glad you mentioned that.
No, they're not going to do that.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because that was not actually my question. And then we could probably, I guess, move on unless you guys have something else to add. Do you guys feel like, because I'll be honest, I mean, I've said on the podcast before that Tekken 7 felt very final, and I was actually surprised that we got a Tekken 8 and then Tekken 8 to this extent. Does this, even though obviously there's a lot more places they can go with the story, does Tekken 8 feel like there needs to be a Tekken 9 in your guys' opinion?
To be honest, no. If they do this DLC rollout right, no.
I mean, I would agree. I don't necessarily need a Tekken 9. You know, you do.
Yeah, because like when I say, bro, the two biggest story concept is like, all right, well, Reyna's mystery, and of course the other Easter egg at the game, you find out June actually is alive and she goes and claims her man. So we just want to know what's
up. When you guys say there's not going to be another Tekken 9, you mean the game won't exist anymore or the characters will be new?
No, I mean more in the sense of like, yeah, like
this could be the final one. If the final product of DLC goes right, technically.
You mean after this, there's no more Tekken?
No more Tekken sequel numbers, yeah. Like, this could be their version of an ongoing, I hate to use the words, but I can't think of a better term, live service Tekken game, where every year to year and a half, they give you quality of life updates, maybe a story expansion pack, a couple of DLC characters. Basically, it's their Smash Brothers Ultimate, put it like that.
For me, if I have a property like this, I don't see why I would do that. I probably would maybe perhaps end that number of storytelling and start a new chapter.
The only
with new characters.
You run the risk of Street Fighter 3. You run the risk of Street Fighter 3.
Yeah.
Street Fighter 3 failed for very particular reasons that could be avoided today.
Not be avoided. That's the thing. It's like it could go either way, right? Where it's like you're at this point, right, where you've managed somehow, when all odds were against you, you put out top quality product. You are unrivaled by your peers in this. This will be on esports for the next 5 years easily. Do you look to top it? Do you feel the need to top it?
Yeah, Jory, because, like, for example, remember this goes back to our past conversation. Look where the state of Street Fighter is in now. They don't know where to take this story. Like, once again, you know, you're starting to kill people off. You know, you got rid of Bison.
That's super solid, man.
Seth is whatever. But then, you know, it's still this lingering Akuma super factor. Solid. But then after he's done, what is there super, to do?
They should have like, solved the problem but by restarting from the very beginning. Let's get everything in order. Because...
Well, bro, that's dragging it on, bro. I do feel like a legacy fighter like this, you gotta find your ways out of it. Like, you know, this is what Issa Rae said about Insecure. Mm-hmm. You don't want to overstay your welcome. Like, you know, you gotta find a good solid cutoff point for this. And then, to be honest, bro, I do feel like I said, you know, going by how they handle it, if this is the final Tekken, I will be satisfied. I would be satisfied, bro. That gives them room to focus on other things. To be honest, you know, depending on how they handle the next Soul Calibur after they did this sort of reboot alternate universe, that could be the final one too. The next one after this one, that could really be it. And they could just move on to something else. Because you could tell some of them are in that phase now, bro. Like, that overhaul is really starting to weigh down, bro. Like, Mortal Kombat has been rebooted. It's the third rebooted one.
Because they've done messed up story-wise.
But that's what I'm saying. It's like you want to kind of bow on top because I think what you're doing, Jory, is good, right? Because you're giving them credit of getting this far and doing this well. But I think for me, it's like I'm also looking at like, okay, here are some of the shortcomings of the company as a whole, right? It's like... CyberConnect 2, right, which I praise and dig on simultaneously. They are undefeated when it comes to anime visuals, but they have the death, fighting death of a puddle on the street. Anytime a fighter gets announced by CyberConnect 2, I cry inside because that is their weak point. They do not know how to make mechanically deaf fighters. They just don't. They're not good at it. They can give you eye candy. It'll be the most beautiful anime game you've ever seen in your life. And you just keep telling yourself, if only they had more fighting mechanics, this game would be gold. And it never happens. With Tekken, this is probably, maybe the third out of eight entries that they've actually got the story, like, right. And when I say right, I mean right enough where you're like, okay, had its problems, but I'm not mad at it. Their level of coherent storytelling is not their best company feature.
So
I don't want them to keep trying in that element.
Because I'm trying to understand. All right, so you guys are saying because the stories end in the game itself.
And the numbered entries, yeah. And the number entries. I don't want to see Tekken Next Generation. I don't want to see the rise of the Mishima successors. I don't want to see that. I'm good.
So, because that's like... But the thing is like, okay, the fight... The reason why the story's a bonus, guys, for certain things. Nowadays... You know, but I mean, if you're gonna play a fighting game, you're gonna fight, right? If you're gonna be a true competitor, Justin Wong is not gonna turn down a good fighting game because the story's not good.
You're right, but it's not a bonus because we've seen games live and die by the story mode. We just said last podcast that Mortal Kombat, once you complete the story, unless you're fighting online, what are you doing?
Well, because they wrapped it around. They wrapped it around the story, you know, that way. You know,
so it can't
they
be
never
a bonus.
Give you more than after
it can't be a bonus then. It can't be a bonus.
For Mortal Kombat, it is.
No, for all... If you look at all these modern fighting games, even with Tekken, even with 32 characters, there is not a moment of like, hey, so-and-so didn't show up in the story. They might not have done much in the story, but every single character that is in the game is in that story mode. Every single character, even if they're sitting in the bleachers of the tournament, it's not a bonus anymore.
Yeah, because the thing is, I don't feel like it's gonna be. It'll be. It's like saying I'm not gonna play Call of Duty because there's not a story mode.
No, all right. No, what we're saying is that you could tell with this injury, they're getting near their exit strategy. That's what we're basically saying. That you know, all right, you know. Depending how this DLC looks, if it's like story DLC to cover up loose ends and, you know, give us some good, you know, legacy and new characters to make us feel like a complete package. To be honest, depending how that story DLC ends and these DSL characters get rolled out, to be honest, this could be the final Tekken and they can move on to something else. Like, bro, and it goes back to another part, past conversation we had about spiritual successors. New IPs. Yes, they could use Tekken as a foundation, but they could move on to something else.
There's a lot of video games and a lot of video game properties, Jujutsu Kaisen, that could benefit greatly from the Tekken Team Engine. Benefit greatly from a dedicated, experienced fighting game company where we don't have to sit there and suffer from some property, some company that said, oh, I'll do it. And we get a half-hearted fighting game because the Tekken team was working on Tekken 11. You know, take some of them resources. It's Bandai Namco. You know what I'm saying? They got the licenses to half the animes we love. It may not be the thing I would have expected, but I wouldn't be mad if a One Piece fighting game was made by the Tekken team. I wouldn't be mad. I know each character would play unique. I wouldn't, you know what I'm saying? That would have been what I expected, but I'm like, okay, they know how to make solid death fighters. Pre-Timeskip Luffy and Timeskip Luffy would play completely different if Tekken team takes care of it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I just don't. To me, this game has kind of felt like I can see, like Tim said, depending on the roadmap of the DLC, how this could be this is Tekken's grand bow out and goes into hiatus until whenever. And we'd be good. We're not missing anything. You drop a good story expansion, quality DLC characters, you add a couple of offline modes or online modes that people can enjoy. Imagine a year and a half from now, they drop a co-op Tekken Force mode. Okay, I'm happy. It's just a game that keeps going. They re-release it, drop Ultimate Edition, drop Ultimate Edition 2 or whatever the case may be, and you're one of the most solid fighting games you've ever played in your life.
Get two more year esports and Call of the Day.
Boom.
Okay.
And then drop Soul Calibur 7. So, last Tekken topic before we move on. They've already announced the beginning of the season pass. They've announced Eddie Gordo, who has also, may he rest in peace, fallen prey to the Killmonger haircut. And when I say rest in peace, I mean rest in peace to Eddie Gordo's original dreads designs, because apparently in Japan, once you've seen Black Panther, there is no other haircut but the Killmonger. So, we've seen him now with this, with the same design. How are you guys feeling about the DLC roadmap, Eddie Gordo being announced, Harada acknowledging that he also has seen the Tifa clip of her juggling people in Final Fantasy VII Remake and is very aware that we all would love her as a guest character. Seeing how you put in Noctis in the last one, what are you feeling about the guest characters and DLC for this coming game?
I'm getting Rugal first, man.
Yeah, who?
Rugal. Rugal. Who? You don't know who Rugal is from SNK?
No.
You don't know who Rugal is?
No.
You played SNK versus Capcom?
No, I haven't.
The boss in the red suit with the panther? Ken Masters with the mustache?
Okay.
Up. Okay. Keep going though.
Y'all boys about to get crucified in the comments this week. My goodness. They're gonna put Rugal first, man. I think Tifa's gonna make it eventually, but that's still up in the air. And the thing,
do you think? To be honest, SNK character crossovers, I think that was just a season because I realized, you know, SNK was getting his mojo back, so they was doing a lot of collaborations, but I feel like now they're filling themselves again, so I don't really suspect another SNK crossover, even though that is a good one. Square Enix crossover, I do foresee that happening, especially the season that we're in, bro. Like, it's literally gold. It is too big of an opportunity to pass by. With the revival of Final Fantasy VII, Rebirth coming out soon, like Tifa as a character, with her, especially her combat style, like, bro, it just makes perfect sense.
It does.
And that's the reason why Tekken 7's guest characters, minus a particular one Anthony didn't like, it made sense, bro. It made perfect sense.
That Rugal up there, man. You got to put SNK versus
Capcom. Oh, my gosh.
Don't put that Rugal up there, man. Yeah, I'm sorry, bro.
But yeah, Tifa. Yeah, because to be honest, bro, like Tekken 7 and Soul Calibur 6, they set the bar heavy when it came to guest characters, bro. So I'm really surprised to see how they're going to outdo themselves this round.
Yeah, I mean, just don't add like Will Smith to the game. You feel me? Like, don't know real people.
I mean, if they could put Negan, anything's possible. So
nah, listen. That was a season, and that was poor returns. Yeah, let's get some Walking Dead fans Negan to play some Tekken. Like,
bro, fire everybody in that room.
Negan was basically what Miguel was supposed to be.
Then put Miguel in the game. Don't worry about Negan.
Oh.
Like Jory said, why in the world would you want Walking Dead fans to play Tekken? That doesn't make any sense. That's not even the target market.
They're gonna ask you for you to be depressed, but you sit in the corner for 30 minutes talking about, like, man, the old days, and this dog food is destroying my insides, man. Where's the nearest bathroom?
Yeah, like, that was very disappointing.
Yeah. Yeah, Negan was just, you know, that was the season. That was the season that he arrived, which makes me think, like, damn, Tekken 7 been around that long? Like, wow. Because to be honest,
there,
bro, like, Harada
used to say,
Harada stated that there was only supposed to be two seasons of DLC. But then, you know, the sales were up and up, so they did 3 and 4.
All the more reason why, again, they don't necessarily need to do a Tekken 9. But I think Eddie Gordo is off to a good start in terms of DLC. It will look a little weird if they just sell us a bunch of black characters, because again, I would want Master Raven to return. But it's just like, so you just gonna sell us who's next, Christy? You know what I'm saying? Like, it's gonna start to look little crazy. Yeah.
You know, so funny, man. Raven is now Grand Raven. Great Raven.
No, she can't be the leader.
Yeah,
she can't be the leader.
No,
she has to be. Not, yeah. That's the thing. They've already written her into a place of, like, she cannot have surpassed Victor now, because Victor is the boss. But
no, but Raven is now Great Raven. So, like, where does that leave her? She's still Master Raven, and then Raven's not Great Raven. Because he gives Raven his sword.
Yikes.
Yeah, that was right there. I was like, okay, but the thing is, there's another story with Zafina. So these things are probably canon because with Zafina, she beats both Devil Jin and Kazuya, extracts Azazel, and then Claudio shoots the Quincy arrow and kills Azazel.
Oh,
and she goes on to a new journey. So.
But
I feel that one, the way it was constructed, it wasn't conflicting with any other endings main story wise. That's why I'm like, oh no,
unless you this one might stick look bad with Master Raven. Unless you want to continue to feed into that conversation that's starting to build of like, where is she? Why don't we have her? And why has she been eclipsed by this white man? You don't want to do that. I've already seen the threads dedicated to where is Jade in Mortal Kombat. So you don't want that discourse to start to pivot and pick up.
Oh no, it's gonna happen. It's coming.
What I'm saying. Let's give them the benefit of the doubt and say that it's non-canon. Because if it's canon, I follow a few accounts and they will not be pleased. I've seen.
Oh no, nah. Hey man, it's gonna.
They
happen,
at Ed Boon every day. Where is Jade? Where is Jade? Where is Jade? So you can put in Chameleon with Jade's moveset, but you can't put in Jade. Oh, okay.
That's crazy.
Lord have mercy.
Well, what do you mean? Why do you need Jade when you have Tanya?
Yeah,
it's just like that movie rule, that Hollywood movie rule, right? Six white dudes in a room and that one black guy that does not, you know, they would never be friends in real life.
So yeah, we're gonna give them the benefit of a doubt and say that, you know, again, we only know Eddie Gordo so far, but I would imagine that whatever the roadmap is for Tekken 8, it should be promising. And again, I think Harada at least publicly acknowledging that people want Tifa is a good sign. And like Tim said, it's like in the year of where cross collaborations are making less and less sense, this actually does make sense. Like the year of Rebirth coming out, this makes all the sense in the world for Square Enix and Bandai Namco to cross collaborate and put Tifa in the game. It's a match made in heaven. The two audiences definitely mingle and match at that point. Square Enix can return the favor with like a Mishima exclusive armor piece, whatever, in Final Fantasy, and everybody wins.
Mm.
You know, I'll be playing Rebirth for the rest of the year, so it's fine with me.
Yeah, we can only hope, man.
It's fine with me.
We can only hope, man.
Okay, so any last closing thoughts on Tekken before we move on to our next story heavy topic?
We can
go on.
So, keeping going with the story modes that we've seen in this past week, Suicide Squad, at the time of this recording, has now officially been released to the public. We were all given the courtesy of having watched the early access cutscenes that were uploaded of the story. Yes, that Discord is definitely coming soon because our group chat was very, very active that day in terms of what was going on. Tim, since you saw it before the rest of us, I'll let you lead the charge. How are we feeling about Suicide Squad Kill the Justice League and its story?
I give it a 5 out of 10. It was a good cutscene movie to watch, but the gameplay and just certain story choices, it was dead on arrival. I do believe ultimately that is a piss in the face to the Arkhamverse.
Elaborate. Tell me more. What?
I didn't even know. I didn't find out till yesterday. It was a part of Arkhamverse.
Because first of all, when you really look at it, and I'll use Arkham Knight. I'll use Arkham Knight as an example. The level of scaling for that game compared to this is just it's two different worlds, bro. And then to be honest, the whole Deadshot switching. Like, I was like, bro, you've used that last Deadshot for 3 Arkham games, and then all of a sudden is this random retcon. And you're trying to make a joke of it, but it's falling flat, bro. It really is falling flat. Like, especially after the, you know, the success of, and you gotta say it for this proper title, The Suicide Squad. Not Suicide Squad. The Suicide Squad. Why didn't you just make this black marksman?
Yeah, or if you're so set on making him Deadshot, kill the first one. And he just said he took up the moniker. It's still lazy, but not as lazy as what they did. Oh, look at this fraud. What? The fraud?
Bloodsport. Bloodsport would have been the easiest one because, you know, you're based in Metropolis and Bloodsport is a Superman villain. So it just kind of felt like, yes, you know, it's in the Arkhamverse, but it's still too heavily Batman oriented because, first of all, if you're in Metropolis, why are all these Batman villains here?
No Metallo.
Why are we doing Riddler trophies?
No Steel.
Why are we doing Riddler trophies again? Why is Penguin
your supplies person?
Oh yeah, Poison Ivy's alive. Okay, that's good, but why is she here? So Lex was randomly in Gotham City around the time and he just captured her seeds and harvested her.
And it's you kill the Justice League, but then no Justice League mainline villains? Like it would make sense. It's a free for all, right? Mm-hmm. No Cheetah villains, no Reverse Flash,
no Metallo,
no Bizarro. No Captain Parasite. Cold.
Also, you know,
Captain Cold.
And you know, this is something that I got from Amanda Waller. You could tell she has a sense of, I guess this is this racism or prejudice, like towards metahumans?
Prejudice.
Now, but then look at prejudice. But then look at the roster. King Shark is technically not a metahuman. He's technically a demigod. And so you have three humans. So, but there's no metahumans. So you mean to tell me she just picked three humans and an Atlantean?
Yeah, that's how you get to it.
And that's it. And then mind you, like, you know, Atlanteans, they know magic, but then the only extent is that to King Shark's magic is his jumping power, like the Hulk. Because, you know, once again, we're following the Ninja Turtles format. The middle range leader, Harley Quinn. And then you got the tech-savvy person, Donatello, Deadshot. You got the quirky trickster, Michelangelo. And then you have the Hulk
with the heart of gold,
Raphael.
Not to mention, he was able to use the Green Lantern ancient technology.
Which was cool. Right. It was cool. I enjoyed watching a green metaphysical shark take a bite out of Brainiac's brain. I'm not going to hold you.
And the level of disrespect for the heroes, though.
I liked it.
Boy.
He summoned that water shark
Don
jutsu, and that was it.
Ancient
revival. That was terrible, dog. Terrible. And in this light, it was terrible. I'm like, man, Captain Boomerang pisses all over.
That was a wild choice. That was a wild choice.
And
there was a couple scenes in on the game. I'm like, but I mean, they're making the rounds on Twitter. I don't know if you guys have seen it, but I'm like, Harley Quinn taking advantage of an incapacitated Deadshot and just groping him. I'm like, had this been a reverse, there would have been a Warner Brothers door. I'm like,
hey, it's a black man.
Hey, come outside, buddy. We're not going to jump you.
it's a black man, dog. You feel me? Jonathan.
It didn't look the greatest. Didn't look the greatest.
And when they kill the four men, members of the league, it's just like, all right, so the boss battle's like, oh yeah, whoever gets the last bullet, the character just falls. I was like, so there's no ending dialogue with these characters. Like, the only one that the only one was Green Lantern. And before,
but even that was it still the same thing. He still collapses, and they're just standing over his like bullet-ridden corpse. Yeah, like this is
corpse.
Wow. Okay.
And then it's just the disrespect. So like, all right, so this is the Arkhamverse. So you mean to tell me after all we went through with Batman as the player, this is how our story ends?
You know, okay. I'm gonna sound like the contrarian because that's been the overall like. Give and take of online about how they treated Batman. Are you guys more upset about the way he died, or are you more upset about what got him there? Because for me, I'm a little bit more upset of how we got him there. Having a boss fight where you fight a fair Batman and you just shoot him over and over and over and over again, and then once the fair is over, he's collapsed, was what made me upset, as opposed to him getting shot by Harley Quinn. That's just me.
Both.
Okay.
And
it's both.
But why?
And then, it's both.
Before I even get into that, the boss battles, I'm fighting Green Lantern, and all he can think about is a turret gun and staying at a distance. He don't get up close and personal. He don't throw launches. He doesn't do not one time he tries to seize any of us. Like how he does in any like he just sees you. He doesn't do any of that, right? So I'm like, some of these fights don't make any sense. What Flash, you know, is just gonna run away, come back. He's not throwing y'all into the yonder zone, separating y'all. Y'all gotta find y'all way back. And like the thing is, like these fights are so nonsensical. I mean, wait, Green Lantern. I said, yo, if this was Cartoon Network Green Lantern, y'all boys would have been. That would have been pressure. That's a compelling game fight. Superman. The Kryptonian. I'm gonna refer to him as the Kryptonian to remove myself from even believing that this person's a person that I could defeat. The Kryptonian. Just zip, talk, zip. Me, the heat beam, ice breath. He don't launch
speed comparable to the Flash.
A vote. Speed comparable. He don't launch a vote. He don't clap. He don't lift the highway over my head. The Superman fight should have been, let's try to escape. Let's lure him to a said location. Have this man Lex Luthor
45 traps.
The Lex Luthor. The fight for Superman should have been everything is on the table.
It should have been God of War 3 Poseidon.
It should have been God of War, not even 3 Poseidon, but it should have been God of War Ascension versus the Hecatonkins. Oh, yeah. Like, what are we doing? Mm. The Kryptonian? Then Batman. That fight should have been the most insane personal fear. Yo, after the fear thing, what really would have upped the ante and turned up the dial on the notch was now you got to fight Batman without the fear toxins, his gadgetry. I'm fighting Arkham Asylum Batman? Batman that took on Al Qaeda?
But you know,
I'm losing my mind. What happened to all the gadgets that buddy had?
The thing that makes it even crazier is that like the elements of the exact boss fight you're talking about is in the game and they just don't do anything with it. When you first encounter him, you remember that part? You're in the museum and he's literally doing the fair takedowns on you. You're losing your party members one by one by one. Buddy jumping out the vents, pulling you from the bushes, just pow.
That, and that's it. You feel me? And it should have been. Yes, it should have been. Oh snap! Deadshot. Where am I? King. Deadshot, help me. You see King Shark tied up upside down. And if you go to that location, that's your head. That's it. You getting plucked. It should have been. I'm like, no, there's no pandemonium. I would have stopped playing the game. I said, yo, I'm going against Batman in his house.
It should have turned to Resident Evil 2.
Oh man, it should have just been that. So I'm watching because I'm like, this don't make no sense. Did you guys see the Suicide Squad cartoon animation? Mm. Batman was a final boss. He was Mr. X. He jumped on the car. The team scattered like ants. These are trained professionals. Scattered like ants, man. And they should have did that version of King Shark versus this one. That would have been a little bit more plausible.
I do too.
I like this I version. Do too. I like this. Because the tattoos, the style, the art style was good. I do feel sometimes the little slowness gets annoying.
They made him Dress the Destroyer, which is a little lazy.
But, yeah.
Dress the Destroyer is always stupid in the movies.
I know.
But
that's what I'm saying. Like they kind of took the easy way out and made him Dress the Destroyer.
Yeah, and then the thing about it is, like I said, bro, I do feel like they should have been a metahuman on the roster.
A few.
Because I do feel... But then you already know that's going to be sold to us through DLC after the Joker.
Like, you could tell it's like these absences.
And that's why I'm glad we brought it up last part about Rocksteady's legacy and how this game will ultimately hurt them, is because we know how meticulous they are. They are very, very detail oriented. They don't drop Easter eggs for the sake of Easter eggs. They don't make mentions to characters that don't come up at some point down the road. That's not them. So for them to have spent this much of time on this game and to have none of the other Justice League villains be anywhere in sight, I'm like, they're DLC. They're season pass content.
Okay.
But this is hurting the game because, like you said, Tim, in what world do I believe that three humans and a shark can take down the Justice League by themselves? With Reverse Flash, nowhere to be found. Metallo, nowhere to be found. Livewire, nowhere. Parasite, nowhere to be found.
Okay.
Yeah.
In his city.
Oh, my goodness. And then now let me go a little further. None of the combat put an emphasis on teamwork. There's no team specials. Flash wasn't utilized. The fight with Flash, Captain Boomerang should have been the main element to use in order to beat. None of these things showed any. You guys need. Okay, for me, I'm thinking, you know, why don't I recruit a villain to help me fight Superman, and then that's how we take him down. That makes more sense, right? Do you realize how crazy Green Lantern was sounding? I've never had that idea, man. Yo, I'm hearing three voices from this guy as he talks. That's terrifying. His introduction, him walking on steps. I said, yo, this is the coolest version of Green Lantern I've ever seen interpreted. And I'm like, I want to read.
Was clean, but keep going. Clean.
I was like, man, they casted the wrong guy to play Hawkman. No Hawkman?
Nobody.
Yeah, because when I started, like, wait, there's only five members. And then even when you hear the story about when Batman comes back, so it was like, so Batman joined the Justice League at the end of his Gotham career? So you mean to tell me, after four sidekicks, this is when he
after
just
joined Jason Todd, Justice after League. Robin becomes Nightwing, after Tim Drake, all of it. That's when he joins the Justice League for the first time. Yeah. But y'all still didn't answer my question. Y'all told me you didn't like you didn't like Batman dying. You just said both and then went off somewhere else.
Okay, yeah, I did say both. Yeah. Okay. Sorry for the tangents, bro. I'm sorry. But this is too much. It's too meaty. It's too weak. Like, okay, both. I say both because it's Arkham. Let's go to, wait. Arkham City. We got Arkham Asylum Batman. Arkham City Batman. Then you have Arkham Knight Batman. Right. Okay. This is the best version of Batman we'll ever get, right? And you beat that Batman, Harley Quinn of all people. That's like a muggle from Harry Potter becoming king of Gryffindor. A muggle, you know, that's a regular human being in the Harry Potter world. That's like one of them thugs that I'm surveying him go. I'm watching him go to location, location. And then me and him in an alley bomb. That's it. There's nothing your goons could. That's what I liken that to. The way Batman went out, there was no. He died on a park bench. To resemble how his parents died. That's so trash. And then Harley Quinn out of out of nowhere. Now she got this pent up. Raging hatred. I'm like, Batman was never your
no,
foe.
No, that one, I'll get pushback. That was built up over the Arkham series. She blamed him for Joker's death.
Okay.
That's always been there.
And this is the Batman that's killing people, too. That's another thing. So this is Batman is off the hinges. Right? Killing people. Not holding back. And now when he decides you get to beat him, I'm sorry. It was just not good. There was no contingency plan. This is Batman we're talking about. No, all y'all sleeping, Batman. Get away into it. No Batmobile was used. No Batcycle. I'm just like, this not Batman. Y'all fighting a fraud.
Okay. Okay. That's a fair point. That's a fair point. Tim, what was your reason? What was your both?
Yeah, it was both. It was just like, first of all, it ruins the legacy, and then like, yes, this is Batman we're talking about. Even when he was under the control of Darkseid in that chair, it's like he had a form of contingency plan. Like, it's like, no. This is a child wrote this.
Yo. The movie's a chair, dog. You seen the chair?
Hold on, I seen the movie.
Because whoever wrote this, they had to know they was going to get pushback from that. And because it's like, bro, you're really spitting on a legacy here that was really built up over time. Even the, you know, this is very funny. Like, you know, a lot of people didn't really care for Arkham Origins, even though it was built.
It was still
by
good.
Another studio.
But the PS Vita version,
and the PS Vita version, which is another side story, which is Arkham Origins Blackgate, that game was better than this. And it's like, no, bro, there's no way Batman should have gone out like that. Or if it was the thing, to be honest, if you want to keep it in the Arkhamverse, let Batman truly did die. Let him die in what he decided to do in that fire, and let him live. Let him just live like that. And you could have chosen another member. You could have chosen, like, there's been plenty Justice League members. You could have chosen somebody else. It was just the icon-ish. And then, of course, you know, I guess the current state of Kevin Conroy at the moment, that they wanted to include that.
I think it's hard to say, right? And that's the reason why I kept... Not, again, I still am not crazy about his boss fight. I don't think I'm like that was just a bad decision. It's just, I can see the dilemma of, you start looking as a company, although understandably you look very biased when out of all the characters, you know, when Superman's getting murdered, Flash is getting murdered, Green Lantern's getting murdered, Batman is the only one that figures it out and escapes or survives or doesn't die, or, you know, whatever the case may be. It's like, it's hard to paint a scenario in which he doesn't die, right? So, like, to me, it's like, a lot of the things that I've seen online is like, I can't believe they killed him. It's like, well, let's move away from the fact that, like, I can't believe they killed him. Like, he should have had a contingency plan. Well, if their whole thing is, well, we can't be biased because we've been making Batman games for 14 years and he has to die, right? Is it more so the fact of how he went out? Because, again, if he has to die, it's okay. It's the how. Okay. I can get behind that.
It's the how.
I can get behind that.
It's the how. Cause, okay, so yeah, he has to die in the game, but how? That's like, there was no... You guys seen The Raid?
The Raid, yeah.
The Raid Redemption? Mm-hmm. Do you remember the last scene where they fought that dude who got stabbed 60, 70 times, then finally died mm-hmm. after they broke his neck mm-hmm. and then his arm? That's all I wanted from Batman. If he was to die, let this be. Yo, you know, I ain't gonna lie, man. This should have been the moment where, yo, Rocksteady, if Batman were to die, man, that's the greatest way to go out, man. Perfect opportunity.
I could see that.
But no, that didn't happen. Mm.
You raise attention up to a point where it's like, yo, it's either him or them. And it, like, it just came down to, you know, whatever at that point.
It should have been 10%. It should have been 10% teamwork. Right? And this 10% is them doing their absolute best. You playing on your P's and Q's. 10% teamwork, right? You guys are another 25% gadgetry. The other 50%, you working with the villains to get whatever you need to get. Then the rest, luck. Right? Mm. Like, give me like, yo, you know what? Only in a video game can you actually beat the Justice League. Okay. Mm. I'll take it. Mm-hmm. But, fans.
Somebody also pointed out that the guns were just too bland. Because, first of all, like, all right, if you're going up against the Flash, you give them ice, hammered melee weapons, but not Captain Cold's or Mr. Freeze's gun? When they just raided a whole warehouse full of old tech, like
no dark side tech from. Hey, listen, you guys need a chance to fight the Kryptonian here. Steel never came out of nowhere to help Superman. Like it don't make and like it just don't. No Jimmy Olsen, nothing. Nothing.
Yeah, that was another thing that we all mentioned in the group chat, is like there wasn't enough context given in the story mode, right? So like one of the things that I liked initially, right, in the first couple hours of the game, is that you're kind of thrown into the mix with no context, right? You're seeing Brainiac's ship in the sky. You've heard that the Justice League was in a fight with Brainiac, and they got overpowered and got brainwashed, and you're trying to like figure out the why. Right, and then eventually the Flash gets snatched up too, but they never explain it. It never gets explained. By the end of the game, you don't know when the fight took place, why they lost, why is this Legion of Brainiacs now from the multiverse here?
Like, thank you, Clone Jutsu.
You know what I'm saying? Like none of that ever gets elaborated on. You never find out why were Flash and Wonder Woman the only two that escaped the initial onslaught out of everybody.
And Wonder Woman didn't get possessed?
And didn't do anything. Like, not for nothing. I understand there's been multiple interpretations of Diana, but I'm like, most interpretations, she's by them, she's with them because they're on the same, they're matching ideals. She's never been these are my friends and I put the friendship before the mission. She's actually usually the opposite. Like, look, y'all are cool, but I'll kill you if I need to. That's usually the impression that we get from her as a character. So this whole pacifist Diana who's getting the whole game, I'm like, man, what are we doing? What are we doing right now?
Yo, I was like, okay, man, because I'm watching and I'm like, yo, this Wonder Woman is number one. I don't know if it's a thing now where they can't look like they're from the Amazons no more. They gotta look like they're from the local city gym. But, you know, that's besides the point. But yeah, she was just not it, man. Like, man, this is the Arkham universe, and I'm not gonna lie, man. I wasn't feeling some of the designs for the Justice League. Like, Batman was probably the toughest looking one, but Superman.
Yeah, Green because they've already too. Done Batman's yeah. design. Like,
Green Lantern was. Green Lantern.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Green Lantern was good.
No, but even with Arkham City, even if it looked base Arkham City, that's still better. I mean, Arkham Asylum.
To be honest, one of the best moments was, oh yeah, he does have a heart. That was one. Yeah.
And you know what? I'm glad you brought that up because that was, I guess, we could probably wrap this up unless you guys have other points. Like, I think that's was the most frustrating part of the story overall, is that you have these moments where it's just like top tier writing. Oh, he does have a heart. Top tier writing. There's a couple of moments that were actually really funny. Like, I laughed like as I was watching the story. We're just like, man, like these character interactions feel very fleshed out, right? Between the Suicide Squad, especially. When you're having those intimate moments where there's not these grand scale things happening, the fact that they took time for both Lex Luthors to have different personalities and different conversations with them, different approaches, how they all interacted with Amanda Waller, and they all had different ways that they viewed her. I thought that was, I'm like, this is so good. We don't get this very often in modern day games.
You know, I was
but
like,
it wasn't
this guy reminds
consistent.
Me of Osborn.
It wasn't consistent. It would happen, and then the very next mission, protect this ice cream truck. It's like, fam, what? Why?
Yeah, a lot of the characters was written well, man. But like, Deadshot didn't take the lead like I thought he would. He was kind of like backup. Mm-hmm. The best character was Captain Boomerang.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Captain Boomerang was the best character. Harley Quinn was Harley Quinn.
Which is still a good thing. She felt on brand.
Yeah.
Felt on brand.
Yeah. Harley Quinn was Harley Quinn. But like, I'm like, Deadshot, you guys went through all this trouble to retcon it, and he's not even like doing top G stuff. You know, it just was like, yo, man, no Slade.
The crazy part is they basically made Deadshot Will Smith's character for the movie. When you mentioned my daughter, I'm like, this is the route you decided to go with the retcon? The Will Smith version of Deadshot?
Way better. if they did Bloodshot.
Bloodsport,
I'm sorry.
Yeah, like this Bloodsport. Is the route you decided to go. DCU
and Deadshot. Bloodsport would have made so much more sense because he would have a uniqueness to him because he has all those type of guns that are just.
Because my thing about it is, and I'm like you put Deadshot, but then technically Deadshot is the marksman that never misses. But when you're playing as him, yeah, you definitely do miss these aliens, bro. There's no
that,
ricochet
and the
bullets.
Fact that his rival is Green Lantern was also like. His rival is Green Lantern?
Where did my two brothers find each other again? And then he shoots him in the head? Y'all guys wasn't thinking about that? I was like, yo. Because that's the first thing I said, wait, y'all boys beefing? Like, what? Off of what? What? A high-class soldier, noble black man versus slums black man? Now, I understand there's a dynamic there when what happened when whites do it? But no, this is what you guys promote on the news channel to correct me when I'm out of line, right? You know what I'm saying? So don't do it in the thing. Don't do it in the game. I just thought that was wild, man.
It did give... there was a little bit of like cringe in it. A little bit of like... It kind of gave the whole... Well, you know, Green Lantern, he's one of the good ones. So it's like... I beg your pardon? Like, excuse me?
Yeah.
One of the good ones.
Yeah, that was... Oh man, dog, I don't know, because that scene I was just like, guys, you guys could have did a better job at this one, man. Y'all should never even put on homie in there. Y'all should have added Cyborg. Where's Cyborg? It should have been Cyborg. Y'all could have even had Hal Jordan. Where's Cyborg?
It's a lot of things, but the thing, and I think it goes back to what Tim said earlier, and then we'll move on, is they didn't do a good enough job establishing what the hero universe outside of Arkham looked like. Right, so like by this point, we were very well informed about what Batman's world here has looked like, right? So when we see the Robin mask in the cave, it's like, oh, rest in peace, Tim Drake, I guess, right? We know exactly which Robin it is immediately because we know the Arkham lineage. In terms of the rest of them, it's like, yeah, we're like, where's Metallo? Where is this? Where is that? But we don't even know what they look like in this universe because when they show Toyman, I'm like. Who is this kid? Who's this Japanese kid?
Oh, you know, yeah, there's well, depending on which iteration, like, remember, there was a Justice League movie where Toyman helped him, but he was like a smart
public
enemy. So they chose one.
Right. Okay. But even in that instance, though, it's like, again, we don't have enough context. Right. So it's like, again, I can appreciate the museum where you're giving us the whole lineage of Batman. And it's like a recap within this little summary, but I know nothing about any of these other characters. Nothing. So even when Lois Lane is commenting about Superman fighting Wonder Woman, like, are they even a thing in this universe? Are they together?
It's basically how they went from Man of Steel to Batman versus Superman. Fast forward.
Ooh.
It was a fast forward, bro. And it's another misstep by DC, as unfortunately. Another misstep, man. All right.
So,
man, that company gone, bro.
So, 10 final score is 5 out of 10. Jory, what was your final score?
2.
It was like a 4 for me. It was a 4. It's that gameplay is just not enough. The story has moments of brilliance, of greatness. The graphics look amazing.
I mean,
but it's not consistent.
No,
there's so much games to play.
What took me out was the rim. Was the rim in the back? I was like, no, come on, bro.
They're obsessed, yo. You know what this game could use? Riddler trophies.
Could you imagine a Mr. Myth Pedalix challenge?
I would have loved that. Lost my mind. I would have loved that. Anything would have been better than Riddler trophies again. Anything. Batmite would have been better than Riddler trophies again. Bat Hound would have been better than Riddler trophies again. Bat Hound and Crypto Dog. I would have taken over.
No Crypto Dog.
Oh my gosh.
No Kira. No. I'm like, yo. Okay. All right,
moving on to our next topic, and I'm gonna let Tim take the lead on this one because I feel like Jory, you and I have spilled our entire creative outlook on this topic loosely in literally the last pod.
Power World releases, does millions on of gameplay players on Steam, is doing numbers, is being talked about. Nintendo's investigating, but it looks like they don't have a case. You know, you're seeing shots of Blikachu, Eradicate, Mewtwo in the chamber. You know what I'm saying? Blikachu. Last Twist, man. With the Thule. You feel me? And you know, we've spoken about this, about how Pokemon and Game Freak need to find ways to elaborate on the types of games and different styles of games that they offer. And Tim, as someone who's been a long-term Pokemon fan, seeing how Power World, although it is distinctly different from Pokemon, and seeing the reception to it, what are your thoughts on how this game has taken over within a week?
It was funny. It was funny to me. Like, it was interesting. And then, you know, I also look at it from a creative side. It was very interesting how people took those modifications very seriously. Like, wow, like, you literally made, like, replicas, almost like Lucario, Mewtwo, very iconic Pokemon, bro. So it really is going to show you, man, you know, there's talent out there, even amongst your audience, that, you know, who wish to be part of these legacy stories. But it's like, you need to hire the right people, man. Because I've come to realize, you know, Pokemon in the design department has been starting to tank. Or even the lore aspects as well. So it's like, you know, you need to tap into this intellectual property out there that are your fans, because this is a direct showcase that's what this fan base is. They are Pokemon fans, and they are using this world to make something of their own. It was funny. It was hilarious.
People want more. People want more. That was the takeaway. I'm like, this should be the biggest wake up call in the world to Game Freak, of like, you can't keep giving us the same thing over and over again. It's over. We don't want to see it no more. And it don't have to be this, right? It don't have to be a Pikachu reference with guns. It's just, we want more. We want more.
Yeah, because this is technically a Digimon reference right here.
More, yeah, honestly.
Yeah.
Even the way they describe the game, I'm like, oh, this is basically Digimon World. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Like, build a bond with your partner, have them fortify your base, hunt for resources. I'm like, Digimon World, aka the superior series. It's just like, why can't Pokemon borrow from these gameplay elements and make a better game? I'll tell you this. Next to a Grand Theft Auto 6 developer, I do not envy Game Freak's position with whatever Pokemon game they do next, because all eyes will be on them. This has to put a battery in your back, I would think, of like, yo, y'all got to figure this out. Because if not, we could start to see the decline of the Pokemon game. Like I said, I don't think any company, no matter what, having a monopoly on any type of franchise is healthy for that franchise, right? So with Pokemon going so long unchallenged in this type of realm, has done more harm than good, because it just gets stagnant. And I think with Power World, it's just like, well, now you see. Of like, again, we don't need this, but we need something. Where is Pokemon 3? Give us another Pokemon Mystery Dungeon. Where is Pokemon Snap 3? You know what I'm saying? Where are these other properties that you guys have done and done well? You know, that you can start to build upon, you know, in these games at this point. You know, you guys have quoted me time and time again, because I think that's their motto. It's like, a child is born every day. And it's the truth. And that's whatever that they'll continue to market to that audience. But it's time to start acknowledging your other audience. You have people who are 25, 30, 40 years old, who've been playing Pokemon since they were kids and still like Pokemon and appreciate Pokemon. Give that audience something. You think the world's going to end if a Pokemon drops a T for T game? I don't think so.
Yeah, because they have been upping their game in terms of Pokemon animation, like new animation styles and shorts and stuff. And of course, you know, the original anime ended and, you know, they started a new one. So you could tell they're taking chances in that department. But, you know, it started out as games, bro. The mainstream games, and even some of their spinoffs, like, you know, there was a certain era, bro, they were just releasing fire, bro. Because I remember that era of Pokemon Snap, Pokemon Stadium, bro. Them trips to Walmart to just to play those games, bro. Like, come on, bro. That was a time.
That was a time. In front of the Toys R Us screen, I'm good.
And then, you know, the GameCube era of, you know, Pokemon Coliseum and Gale of Darkness, bro. Which, you know, people have said it, man. Those were the Bloodborne games of Pokemon, bro. Like, those games were brutal. Like, you had to be strategic. You needed to know type advantage. You need to know how to use items, turns, or how fast is your Pokemon. So that way, you know, you hit them next or you're dead. Mm-hmm. You had to know Pokemon, bro. There was no ash luck in those games. Mm-hmm. So yeah, man, this is interesting. I'm interested to see how far this goes, especially, you know, like almost like how Fortnite just took over. Like, you never know how far this may go. So I'm interested to see.
It's gonna go far.
You're right. I think it will definitely depend on the resources that get put into this game. But seeing how well it's done, I would imagine those resources are coming. I'm sure there's an investor right now that's like, tell me what you need.
Because this kind of reminds me of Genshin Impact, bro. I remember I heard that. I turned around. Next thing you know, over 1 million+ downloads and growing. I was like, oh, okay.
And look at no pun intended. Look at the impact it's having the industry. Now you can't blink without seeing an anime inspired character design. You can't.
Yep.
Everything is anime inspired now. Everything. When we get to the showcase, I'm just like, so y'all took Genshin Impact character designs. Keep going.
You know what's so crazy? The next Guilty Gear game that dropped is going to do flying colors. Because now people are like, you know what? Their eyes are like, I want this style. Mm-hmm. Kind of like how we felt when we were growing up. I look at Superman on WB. I'm like, this is cool. But where's the guy in the orange suit? Man, where's the guy with the spiky hair with the pole and the flying cloud? I like that style. And anything that looks like it, I'm eating it up. Mm. And there you have it. And then this works on so many levels. Because I was like, man, I want to play a Pokemon with guns. This is just a rowdy version of it. It caters to a desire that everybody had. You know? So, like, you open the door. Why'd you put two bazookas on Blastoids, man?
No, you're right. You put two bazookas on Blastoise. You're telling me, right? It's like, this is not, we're not making it up. It's not child theory. The game Pokedex, Cubone is wearing the skull of its deceased parent. Ghastly, Haunter, and Gengar are the spirits of dead Pokemon. This is your lore.
You did it to yourself.
But I keep waking up in the Pokemon Center saying? When I get jumped by Team Rocket. Something not adding up. I need to see a game over screen.
You know what I'm saying? Y'all did it to himself, man. Eddie Young. Now you. I mean, I got Pokemon with AK for Kalanishka coughs. And I'm like, dog, I'm in heaven. I'm like, I would have been modded the game to do that. Now you know they're gonna do now. Once they get a storyline, oh my goodness, it's gonna take off just like PUBG. Mm-hmm. It's gonna take off. And now if you're not playing this game, are you playing Pokemon?
At your big age, when you be playing Power World,
we used to play that. And then they gonna get all the rejected fan art that Pokemon never took the opportunity to say, hey, this makes sense. Let me hire you. They're going.
Because you know what's one of the interesting things about Power World? Because, you know, yeah, it has those Pokemon and Digimon elements, but it also has elements of one of those cousin animes, Monster Rancher. It has
one of the underrated gem.
It was that younger cousin that, you know, yeah, you're there for the kickbacks and the family events, but whatever.
Bro, I was hooked on that storyline. When the wolf found out he had another brother, I was waiting for that season to finish. When they finally made it up to that man named Moo, I was red kid. I was like, yo, when I saw the one eye in Monster Story, whatever, I was like, man, you a fraud. I already seen the original of the one eye monster that sounded like Krillin. Yeah, man. I don't even know his name, but whatever.
I know you're talking about, though. That's the first thing I think about. The first thing I think about was the one-eyed monster that was the yellow skin.
It has that Monster Rancher elements. Like, because one thing about Monster Rancher that a lot of people love was, like, you know, of course, all three of them, Pokemon, Digimon, Monster Rancher, they all had great designs. Monster Rancher had that lore, that interesting lore. But yes, you know, Digimon had that too in terms of character development, you know, but it was more about the partner relationship with Digimon.
Mm-hmm.
But Monster Rancher had that lore. Yeah, like even the background characters, like, they all have very interesting stories, man. Hair is the way, because it is when the wolf lost his pack and things of that nature. So, like, it all aligned up so well. So yeah, man, it has elements of all three. And that's why it's a very dangerous contender, bro, especially in this current market.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, obviously, like, I mean, let's all be realistic here. It's like, this is not getting Pokemon out the paint anytime soon.
Yeah.
Obviously, it appeals to a specific audience. But I think it just ultimately, it's just interesting because it goes to show of what is potentially going to be building up as a landslide. When it comes to Pokemon, of like, again, you have this audience that you continue to neglect, this older audience that still loves this world, still loves these characters, still loves the concept, but is tired of being treated to the same adventure that they were subjected to when they were 8 and 9. Give them something that appeals, you know what I'm saying? Split some of your huge team off to develop an Arceus 2 that has a lot more mature elements. That play into things that we as adults or older teens or young adults can relate to, and continue to crank out your Let's Go, I don't know, Cyndaquil. You know what I'm saying? For the younger audience, you can do both. It's fine. So, I was just curious, but moving right along, Jory, you're up next. Your company, your software, your hardware company, they put out an Xbox Direct. You had a couple words to say, in particular in the group chat, about the way they handled your boy, Indiana Jones.
Oh.
Yeah. So I wanted you to, you know, voice some of that on the podcast about, you know, the first person Uncharted.
You know, I think a YouTuber mentioned that, oh, you know, now that the noise has died down, I guess people are starting to come around now, like the first person. I'm like, nah, man. Okay, listen, you're not gonna spend all this money, all this time, all these resources just to give me another first person game and fight for it and expect me to be okay with it because it was made by the people that made Wolfenstein. Or whoever made it. That's great. That's great, man. But I'm tired of these first-person games. Stop being a first-person shooter box, man. Because that's what you're selling me. Now, I can understand if this was pre-production and it already... But you have the power to... Hey, listen. What's the point of me watching Indiana Jones whip and swing around in third-person only? I'm sorry. I'm not having it. You could have easily just had... your personal Indiana Jones adventure in third person, and it would have been a step in the right direction. Why waste all this graphics for me to look at everything through how I'm looking at real life right now? I'm tired of it, man. That's part of the reasons why I was a little disappointed in Cyberpunk. Okay, I'm in this world, and I create my own character, and I gotta look at myself through a mirror.
I'm surprised, though, because I thought that you enjoyed first-person shooters, though.
I do, but I don't want that for everything. How many first-person shooters do I need? And if I got this console, okay, first-person shooter here, first-person shooter over here. Let me play this first-person shooter. What's the difference? All of it starts to bleed into one. Why? Because one, in this game, I could drag a man across the floor and put him in a dumpster in first person. And in this one, I could... Oh, man, I'm okay, man. And in this Indiana Jones, out of all the properties, you want to make this first person. Then you already got Laura Croft. You already telling me we're going to reinvent first person for this next game coming out called... not StarCraft Ghost, man. Perfect Dark. I'm over it, man. I'm tired of these first person games. It's missed opportunities. I'm not asking for an open world. Just give me something different, Xbox.
Yeah, I will say I was a little surprised that they would go through all that effort, like you said, Jory, of recreating Harrison Ford's
likeness. The way they promoted it.
To make it a first-person game.
I was like,
what?
Like, I might as well just watch the movie. I'm like, wow. Like, and then there's parts where he's swinging he's just swinging with his own whip in first person. Man, I don't want to play this. This game, once it come on Game Pass, I'm just gonna let it pass. I'm like, oh, this. Guess what's leaving this week on Game Pass? Goodbye.
But do you feel like is it more so because that's not what you would have wanted from an Indiana Jones game, or is it just first person fatigue?
It's an Indiana Jones game, and it's a compilation of both. You're giving me Avowed. Then you're telling me to be excited for Avowed. You're telling me to be excited for Stalker, first person. You're telling me to be excited for Skyrim, first person. You're telling me to be excited for what's the game called? Not StarCraft. That game that came out. Didn't get it. Starfield. Good thing it's a little bit of both. You're lucky. Because if it was first person, coffin. Flatline. First, that's already five, right? You're gonna get Blizzard. You're gonna go get Blizzard. You're gonna go ahead and go get what's the next Inquisition that they got? All half of them things is first person. Not one is third. Not one's an action game that you promised me. Nothing. So what am I being excited for?
That's fair.
Oh, good job, Xbox. First person again, man. This time, I can swim in first person. Like, I'm in first person right now. Right now. Right now in first person. You think I care? I don't care. Unless I'm in... And then even with that, right? Like, with Halo, I forgive Halo. Because Halo's world... And artistry just does something to me to where I'm like, wow, this is fun. It's combat. I'm a super soldier in the year, whatever. I'm using weapons I've never used before, but even that gets stale. Why? Because the guns, right? Halfway across space, we mastered space travel. But then the aliens have a scope too, just like my sniper rifle? That's crazy. Well, it's a sandbox game. I'm like, listen. I understand, right? We're limited to the technology at hand, right? But it doesn't hurt, right? Turok had very unique weapons. Resistance Fall of Man has very unique weapons. That's all I'm asking for. Let the guns feel alien again. Because there was a time nobody was doing sticky nades. Sticky nades is everywhere now. Let's do something new.
Fair point.
Let's do something different. Right? How many games where I'm using intergalactic space travel, but then I gotta go to my old trusty, whoosh, my old trusty grappling hook. Oh, dude, that's so innovative, man. Like, no, bro. I wanna see energy particles pull that string. Like, Samus could do it. Master Chief, why can't you?
So what if... What if they have a very intricate combat system with Indiana Jones' whip? Does that change nothing? What if you...
In first person?
I said, what if? We don't know. They must feel pretty confident to be like, we're going to give you whip mechanics in the first person. Maybe we'll have limb targeting, right? Where you can hit arm with you, if you hit the arm.
Let's take what you said. Let's take what you said, right? Imagine Sony Spider-Man 3, Spider-Man 4. The game, but this time you get to web in first. You want to do a backflip as Spider-Man in first person? Good luck finding where your enemy is on the screen.
Dead.
Your neck's gonna snap. I don't care.
I'm not interested. I'm not the person to try to win over it. So why a first person would be better?
I'm not interested.
A third person in any category ever. Like I told y'all both before, the fact that I cannot strafe behind a building or a wall in first person. Throw the game away. It's supposed to be lifelike.
Forget it, man.
You can crouch and stand up. You can slide. okay, I can also peek out. No, you can't. You'll get shot. What? Excuse me? That, you can't see that, outside your line of vision. Thing. What? In a video game?
Yeah, in a video game, right? You know, I could see the comment section. What is this guy talking about? He's going from this to that to Halo. I'm saying Halo is an exception. I did go on a tangent because there were some personal feelings I have about Halo that I feel like needs to change. And I'm going to get to it. I'm going to dissect and get into the Halo community because they need a little talking to. Now, back to Indiana Jones. I was going to say, final thoughts on Indy. You have Uncharted. Now, I'm, as a CEO, I want to compete with Uncharted. Right? Let's get a name brand that everybody else knows. Right? Because that movie that we just released is trash. Garbage. The last two after that were just as bad. Let's try to do something new. If it's not working in the silver screen, let's do it on the OLED screen. Let's get that going for us. Let's do third person. Tomb Raider works. Why not keep this adventure as Indiana Jones and we focus on the story, we focus on the intense dialogue, we give you choice options, some scenarios play into your favor, some don't. Let's do that. No. First person again. Just because it looks great don't mean I'm going to eat the cake. Sorry. Graphics and then what? Graphics and then what, Dragon Ball Z fans?
Whoa. Thank you for saying that, because I was about to chime in on that one.
Let's not get ahead of ourselves. I want to broaden the conversation a little bit. Because you brought up You brought up a good point, right? My bigger question than this, right? And this is for both of you guys, and I'll give my thoughts first, is while I did think in comparison that the choice was a little random, right? I could see the appeal last year of releasing a RoboCop game, right? Because no matter when you put out a RoboCop game, it's going to feel futuristic. You could even release a RoboCop game this year in third person instead of first person, and it'll still feel different, right? Because of how advanced RoboCop was at that time. When I think of Indiana Jones in general, the franchise, I'm thinking this was a property that not for nothing was just a little bit older than even all three of us. So when I look at this game, I'm like, and respectfully speaking, right, in a franchise that in a lot of ways gave birth to the Uncharteds, gave birth to the Tomb Raiders, gave birth to a lot of these games that pull from these elements of a human goes on a supernatural adventure, why do these companies think that a Indiana Jones game for our generation and younger, because none of our dads is picking up an Xbox, was the property to go for with this game? Does that make sense? Like, why would you think to yourself, like,
yeah, wow,
this will get the action adventure game we need is an Indiana Jones game out of anything? I could even see Mission Impossible, to be honest with you, before I saw Indiana Jones. I could see recreating Tom Cruise's motorcycle stunt from all six Mission Impossible movies in first person being a little bit more visually appealing than swinging on Indiana Jones' whip through the jungle. But maybe that's just, I don't know. So that's my question to you guys. Like, what is it about the Indiana Jones property that says, like, let's make this our big budget, big license game, also voiced by Troy Baker?
I think it's just to share that spotlight of the other two, because you know, as of now, Uncharted has come to a close. Tomb Raider is openly ended. So it's like, you know, yes, let's choose another mascot to bring back to life. I do feel like Indiana Jones would have worked better if it had an anime component. Whereas, like, you know, like a story where, you know, we're going on this journey and there's different animations that, you know, use the same voice actors from, you know, the game, and that could have worked out, because I even understand the whole Troy Baker aspect. I understand that perfectly, because you could tell certain people, they trying to go back to that era where Troy Baker was everywhere. So I get it, but I do feel like the first person was a very, very bad call. Somebody truly dropped the ball on that, because that just makes a lot of disconnection, I would say. Because I've always felt that, especially these treasure hunter games, they've always been best as third person, because you're trying to get immersed into the environment. Mm-hmm. You know, like I would say this for Tomb Raider, like when I, you know, when you fight the wolves or the leopard and stuff like that, the leopard goes into a hole, the leopard might pop up right behind you. How are you supposed to do that in third person? Oh yeah, you're going to turn it into a quick time event. That's why.
Quickly spin your camera around with your right trigger.
No.
Your right analog stick.
So it was a
quick
bad call.
3 second countdown.
It was a bad call, but I do feel, you know, now is a good time to really make new decisions, bro. Because as you can see, Ubisoft did it. Ubisoft's like, oh, y'all don't like that first trailer? Scrap the whole game. Scrap it. Because to be honest,
they give us one of the best Prince of Persia we've ever seen.
Even though the Indiana, the style that they chose for this new Prince of Persia, I could even see Indiana Jones benefited from that. That Metroid 2D-ish style. Like, you know, because we've seen it back in the day, like with the Aladdin games, all that other stuff. We've seen that work. Because it will work well for traps. Oh, here's a spike pit. If you miss that whiplash at the last second, you're dead.
Can I say something, man? To be honest with you, I was never a big fan of Indiana Jones. I was always bored.
Why would you? It's not our generation. That's what I'm saying. Like, and that's the thing that, like I said, that's the thing that I wanted to ask both you guys. Is I'm like, I know, technically we were alive, right? We were around for a good chunk of like his legacy movies. We existed. But it was like, it was one of those things where it's like, remember how like the first time you discovered James Bond, and like in your mind you're just like, oh, Pierce Brosnan, who else could that possibly been? And then you find out there's like James Bond from like 1965, and you're just like, oh, okay, right? It's like, that's how I felt about Indiana Jones. I'm like, oh yeah, Indiana Jones, the guy with the big boulder. It's like, no, that's like his third movie. I'm like, third movie, what else was there? You know what I'm saying? Like, but go ahead.
Okay. Like, I feel like, you know, out of any game you guys could have chosen to movie, why not The Mummy? That's a way more fun movie. That would have been a way more fun game to play with the graphics or with the presentation that Indiana Jones has. You're playing as very likable characters. You have the character Brandon Fraser plays. I forgot her name. Just a very unique world already. That would have been a very fun game. The scene in London in third person, with the choreography and the graphics that Uncharted has, and the choreography from how it's presented in Indiana Jones, with a little bit of survival elements from Tomb Raider, and some Hocus Pocus. Let's do it. That would have been a way more fun game. I don't see. Well, I'm fighting Nazis. Again, I'm fighting Hitler's spear. Again, I mean, again, you know, like, I'm fighting them again. Great. Fine. That's cool. It's not for me, man.
Okay.
So, you know, it's not for me. A lot of the games I'm gonna be playing this upcoming summer, it's on the PS5. once Grand Blue Fantasy drop, kid, my finances.
Welcome to the fold, my brother. Welcome to the fold.
Hey, listen, Tekken's on the Xbox. Tekken's on the Xbox. But this summer,
with open arms, my brother.
This summer, kid, I'm taking a trip. I'm in Canada right now, man. I'm in Canada, bro.
We not like y'all. The doors are always open when you want to come home.
Cause, you know, it just Do you guys not look at your inventory? And not see FPS, PF, FPS, 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 and not feel nothing?
Well, I mean, you could then argue with PlayStation that you see third-person action adventure, third-person action adventure, third-person action adventure, foam stars, third-person action adventure. It's like,
no,
to be fair.
No, you're right. Sony does have the whole depression template. I hate my dad. My dad hate me back. You feel me? Storytelling. They got to fix it. They got to do something with that. But I forget it when I'm playing Ratchet and Clank. I forget it when I'm playing... Give me a game. God of War. I do.
You know it is. I hit my dad.com. Pretty much. It's a template of I hit
it
my
is,
dad.
It is. It is. I forget it. I forget it if I'm going to play a fighting game. Like some of the arcade games that's on there, I'm surprised nobody promotes them. But they're good. Mm. They're good. Those low-key Sony exclusives, they're good. You know, I'm
Final Fantasy VII Remake, good. You know?
Yeah, man. And then, you know, with that being said, like, it's just for me, very frustrating. And then now, for me, I'm an action guy. You know, we can go on to the next subject. I think I said all I need to say about the Indiana Jones game.
The next subject is the other showcase that took place. We had a PlayStation Direct that took place during this week. 45 minutes-esque of content was revealed. Some first-party games, others third-person, and third-party games. Sorry, not third. Well, they were third-person, but third-party games as well were unveiled, one of them being a Sonic Generations remaster, which was surprising. We also saw the return of Silent Hill to the mainstream with both a remake and a free-to-play game. And, you know... Yeah. Unfortunately, they didn't fully dodge the allegations and the rumors, but the PortStation 5 reared its ugly head once again with the remaster of Until Dawn for the PS5, because that's just what this generation is just getting shinier graphics and upgraded details and higher resolutions on games we've already played not even a generation ago. But, you know, and, you know, y'all favorite boy, Hideo Kojima, showed up and showed out. So how are you guys feeling about the state of play?
I'll go first. I enjoyed it. I gave it like an 8 out of 10. Because, you know, I'm in the market for something new. Stellar Blade. I really like what I saw. I really enjoyed what I saw. I mean, the Twitter is already going a little ham on some of the moments of the trailer.
Oh,
highlighting the physique of the character. as usual. But I'm really interested to see how that world turns out. And, you know, the combat is, like how you said, like, bro, like, animation is getting so close to anime that it's just like, wow, this character is gorgeous. And, you know, and it kind of gave me that. And I like the fact that, you know, the player is a woman as well. Because I kind of feel like, bro, it was giving me that Heavenly Sword vibes. Heavenly Sword would mix with Nier Automata type of thing, post-apocalyptic type of stuff. So I'm looking forward to that. Sonic, man, the kid in me woke again. I was like, thank you so much. Like Shadow, I'm glad Sega is starting to really understand what they have. But one thing I'm scared about, especially for Shadow, I hope he doesn't become the Virgil mechanic. Like, oh yeah, we're going to release a Sonic game. Oh, but Shadow's going to be DLC. I was like, no, we're not doing that. This is your second time?
No, I don't think so.
I don't think so either, but this will be the year to determine it. Yeah. I saw someone on Twitter call it the year of Shadow, because we're getting Shadow's DLC for Generations and Shadow's the main antagonist of Sonic 3.
Yeah.
And he's played a significant part in Sonic Prime.
Yeah. And it's like, I was like, bro.
Super popular.
So I was like, bro, I do not want Shadow as DLC ever again. So whenever y'all make Sonic Frontiers 2, don't play around. But I'm interested to see what that DLC brings, man. Sonic Generations was a beautiful gem. Like, now they tanked when they went to Forces. I don't know what they were thinking with that. But Sonic Generations is great. And the fact that we're literally getting shadow-based fights. So I was thinking, because there was one particular fight they didn't highlight. And that was from Sonic 06. That demon that took on his form. Mephiles. So like they highlighted Black Doom from the Shadow of the Hedgehog game, and then, you know, they brought back the OG from Sonic Adventure 2, Bio Lizard. I was like, bro, like that Dreamcast era, like, really arose in my heart, bro. I was like,
no, that game was fire. Bro, that game was fire. That was the greatest Sonic like, game I've ever
played. Pre-order already. I don't care. Yes, it's a remaster, but that is one that is worth it to me in my eyes, of because you know, as I said, when we're adults, it's about what we want, and that show was exactly what I wanted. Like if it was just Sonic Generations by itself, like how they did Colors, then I would have been like, pass. But I was like, hold up, well, like, wait, these are ground up, built from the ground up stages.
Yeah, but it doesn't bother you at all that all the shadow content is kind of separated from the main game? Like, they've already kind of...
But that's what I said. That's my only fear, because he was DLC for Sonic Forces. Even though the main bad guy had a vendetta against Shadow, but why are you after Sonic? And that's what's made Sonic Forces... I'm like, bro, he's mad at Shadow, not you. But Shadow is DLC. So I'm just hoping that, you know, Sega's not following Capcom and making Shadow the Virgil aspect of, you gotta pay for this, bro.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's only so many times they could do that with Devil May Cry. Because Devil May Cry 5, as much as people like it, there's a lot of dissatisfaction with it. So it's not, it did good, but the taste in the mouth is not good. So
okay,
I don't think that's gonna happen with Sonic. I think Shadow now has too, he stands out too much. Not in a cult, not like in a fan base setting. It's more like, no, he's just as popular. And if they pull up Toriyama, then that's, hey, throw your cards in the air, throw the paperwork in the air, throw everything in the air. But I don't think that's gonna happen with Shadow. He's too iconic now, especially with the Prime series. He has so many lines. He's too well written.
They have to solidify and it's like, to you know, him in the live action one, though. That's going to be the make or break.
Yeah.
If he crosses over the mainstream, then it's over. But that will be like the
break. But you know what sealed the deal for me was Sonic Team is going to be handling it. So that gives me faith that this is not going to just be a port of trash.
Yeah, I'm a little skeptical, because like I said in the group chat, I'm like, one thing that Sonic Team does well is they will take a great idea and fumble it somewhere between idea and execution most of the time. You have to have a couple ideas sometimes where it's like, it's honey, sweet nectarine of an idea. And then other times where it's just like, you said it yourself, look at Sonic Frontiers DLC. Of course it makes sense to make all these characters playable. Why does it feel like none of the mechanics of the game fits any of their movesets? What was the point of this? Nothing about this this world was fit for any of their movesets. Why did you even do this if that was the case? And that's been their track record for the longest time. This is a great idea. Why is it playing out like this? So that's the only reason why I'm a little hesitant. I'm like, hold on now.
It comes out in the fall, so that also gives me much hope that, okay, this is getting significant amount of time worked on it. Because, you know, they did good, especially when they the other game that they released outside of Frontiers, where it was like an homage back to the old games, but it had a updated story and new characters. That one did very, very well. So it's like they are Superstars? Working. Yeah. So like they are doing good in certain areas. So that's why like I feel they're starting to really understand what's going on here. Because he had the Sonic Frontiers. Yeah, Knuckles, Tails, and Amy is like you just took tech demo characters and put them in the same world as Sonic. Sonic may cry, but is but then I know for sure the next one is going to be more solidified.
Okay, so those the stand. Okay, can we talk about Rise of the Ronin? And is it safe now for me to say that a lot of games are pulling from Ghost of Tsushima? Can I say that now? Because the last time I said that, you guys were like, "What are you talking about?" You know, I'm like, "Fam, what are y'all talking about?" Every single thing is set in feudal Japan.
Well, they have to capitalize on it because Ghost of Tsushima did something that people were telling them for 10 years.
I think they're capitalizing on the time period. Like you saw, like, you know, what we saw with Blue Eyed Samurai when the Japanese opened themselves up to the British with guns and all that other stuff. I feel like a lot of, like, they're taking inspiration from that era because, you know, he has a sword, he has a gun, he has a shot, he has a rifle. Next thing you know, he has a kite glider. And of course, there was some Ninja Gaiden aspects. Oh, I'm looking forward to it. It looks interesting to me. I'll check it out.
Team Ninja, man, they like not good at building interesting levels.
It felt, I was thinking the same thing. I'm like, it just looked so dated to me out the gate.
It's like the combat is actually more fun once you play it than it looks. Cause I like Neo. I do. Mm-hmm. I do like Neo. The combat is superb, but I hate the way Team Ninja's animations are. Like, it's so stiff.
Very Dynasty Warriors.
It doesn't feel. Yeah, like it doesn't. You like, I'm watching them run, and it's like a. It's not like a.
It don't feel weighted. It don't feel
the one part.
It just doesn't.
Yeah, the one part I felt was a bit off was the glider part. I was like, bro, you definitely almost crashed into that building. Where's the momentum with this glider? Is it just like one of those? Oh, if it's activated, you could just go through anything. No, you almost hit that building, bro.
Yeah.
And then where'd the horse come from? Did it like spawn from the ground and he just lands on it? No, the horse don't buckle. Just up. That's why I hated Wulong. I was playing Wulong. It was fun for a while, but then after that, I'm like, yo, the way everybody feel, I can't, like, listen, if I'm playing a game where you giving me Chinese Dynasty War, like, if I don't jump on a leaf, I don't want nothing to do with you. Mm. If I'm not running on top of the water, because what are you offering me? That's not the world I see. Mm. That's not the world that fantasy takes place in. Those fight scenes never go like that in any of the genres or the mythology film pieces or TV shows in China that air those type that time period. Them fights never go that way.
Even in Ghost of Tsushima,
what's going on?
More like Rurouni Kenshin than anything else, where it's like you had these quote unquote supernatural elements that once you got into the fight were further explained of like, oh, he managed to figure out a way to keep his sword on fire by wrapping it in a special type of oil that burns slow, right? But the legend was he's the burning sword samurai who can ignite his sword whenever he wants, right? But it's still grounded, right? It's still grounded. Yeah. Versus, like you said, like if you're going to go fantasy, you can, right? No one's saying that it has to be historically accurate Japan, but you got to go fully grounded or fully fantasy. It can't be this weird mixture of like you get to pick and choose when it becomes realistic versus not.
And I think they shot themselves in the foot because now you're only releasing on one platform. It's not going to go nowhere. It's because it's not better. You're not offering me something better than Ghost of Tsushima on paper. Mm. You know, now the combat might be something fun, you know, but here's what's going to make or break your game. The boss battles, the scenarios, because the world itself doesn't look, you know, that interesting. Mm-hmm. What's that game called? Assassination Zero? That game looks incredible. You know, but what you're offering me, I'm not interested. Like, you know, like, I'd rather wait for Yakuza's version of what you're trying to do. And I'll play that because I know I'm going to leave with something. Mm-hmm. I'm going to leave with something because this not it, man.
Okay.
Yeah, I lost all interest. I think it died. I think it died because I thought about it. I said,
yeah.
No cherry blossoms. The city formation is bland. Yeah. The dirt on the ground is like no color. Where's the market? There's like a marketplace that would be here, you know, postponed. And you coming out the day of what game? Dragon's Dogma? After I saw that trailer, bro, when they were switching the weapons mid-fight? Yeah.
Like I said in the group chat, the Dragon's Dogma trailer dropped. I was like, there goes Dory Game of the Year. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. Homie switched to the bolt, to the grace. Yeah. He countered the. Yeah, it's a wrap. It's a wrap, bro.
How do you guys feel about
it? Yo, in the clip for Ronin, just put the Dragon's Dogma, man. Just about to slap off on Ronin. Like, because it's that. It's that. Y'all should have just dropped Neo 3. Open world Neo 3. Good job.
Man. How do you guys feel about Silent Hill getting a remake announced and the free-to-play game being, I guess, either announced / shadow dropped? Certain people have played it already.
I like the direction for both the free to play scared adventure because it did remind them of PT. And then, you know, they're reviving the second one as well, you know, in modern day aspects of it. I do feel like that's a series that has been dormant for a while. And I keep telling people all the time, bro, PlayStation 1 and PlayStation 2 have some very, very hidden gems from our past, bro, that if you would have brought them into modern age, bro, like, it would just be mind-blowing of how much depth, even back then, how much those games had. So I'm glad that they're starting to, like, you know, tap into different properties because, like how you said, Konami is in a very weird place, bro. A very weird place.
All they've had for years is Yu-Gi-Oh! And pachinko machines. So just
I mean, I'm interested to see what they're trying to do with it. I am hopeful because even like Sega. Sega has realized, you know, we got some real hitters under our table that we need to like push forward. So the same thing with Konami, man. Like, get that fire in you. And make some rightful business decisions. Like, yes, you know, you and Kojima have parted ways, but that does not have to be the end of you.
Yeah. And that's like sincerity. They have more than just Metal Gear Solid. You have a lot more to bring to the table than just Metal Gear Solid.
Yeah, so like, you know, really truly push the genre forward, man. And then, you know, speaking about people going forward, like, you know, Hideo Kojima and Death Stranding 2, bro, like, that was a game I did not expect a number 2 so quickly.
Me either.
Oh, y'all surprised?
Yes.
What? This was in the making. I follow him, so I was already waiting.
The reason why, it might be different from Tim's. My only reason why is because I know that he was already rumored to be working on other stuff for other studios. So when he did the whole thing with Jordan Peele on stage, when we're making this, whatever, for Xbox, I'm like, okay, this is your next baby, right? This is your next project. I didn't think that. Yes, I'm working on this, but I'm also putting the finishing details on Death Stranding 2. You know what I'm saying? And I was like, oh, okay. And it has a release window. I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah, like, you know, I'm just glad that, you know, Kojima is really back into the mix of things. The gameplay was very interesting. And, you know, the whole guitar rail gun really tripped me out. And just even the, I wouldn't call them gory elements, but like just the weirdness of the world, bro. Like the surgeon scene with the tar. That's it's like, bro, like this is a very interesting world.
He's doing what Dune does, Star Wars does. You name it, man. That's pinnacle creativity. It was so strange that you can't look away. Right? And now what was missing in the first Death Stranding is now in this one. We said, yo, listen, it's a game at the end of the day. Right? It's a... Yeah. Right.
Not a UPS simulator. I'm sorry.
To reconnect the world through through the internet, whatever the plot was in that first game. Because boy, I was like, man, this is about to be the greatest game of all. But now he did it, and I'm happy he did it. I heard the director's cut for the PS5 is the greater, superior version. So I'll get that one.
Mm-hmm. Sure, sure.
I'll get that version.
I'll never know.
I wish I could see you guys' faces. I can't. Yeah, so I'm going to get that version most definitely, man, and play that version. Well, this new one, that definitely was the highlight for me. That and Stellar Blade. Is it Stellar Blade?
I did feel like the Death Stranding trailer was a bit long. I was like, because I was expecting something Spider-Man or Final Fantasy. Yeah, I was Kojima, like, bro, like, this trailer kind of long, bro.
Tim, you triggering me right now, bro.
I was like, because I was upset.
I was upset.
Because I was like, bro, like, Spider-Man came out in September.
It's two parts, so it's stuff to look forward to. I actually like the fact that it's not that far apart. Like, it's next week.
No. The second part is dedicated strictly to Final Fantasy. Know,
Spider-Man's strictly going to Final Fantasy. They obviously not happy back at the studio because of how everybody receives certain things, so.
Yeah, but the fact that, because the thing on top of that is, what made it weirder is like earlier that morning before they did the direct, Insomniac did this whole director-to-director sit down where like the game director of Spider-Man 2 sat down with the movie director of Across the Spider-Verse to have a conversation about Spider-Man. So I'm like, oh, in my brain, I'm like, oh, the day of the state of play, you're doing this little director thing because you're going to announce something dope Spider-Man related. Hey, guys. By the time this state of play drops, New Game Plus will be available to download onto your game. Enjoy.
No.
Thank you guys for supporting us through our dark times during the holidays. And I'm like, yo, we're back. Nothing. Nothing. No costume. Not even Mission Select. Nothing. So for me, who definitely respects Kojima, definitely acknowledges his creativity, right? Definitely salutes him in everything he does. I was not a big fan of an almost 9-minute trailer of a game that's left me just as confused as almost every other thing he's ever done. I don't need to see the announcement of, hey, Kojima is not only doing that, but he's also returning to the action espionage franchise. Hey, not only that, we're gonna let Kojima make his movie. Okay. And this has been our PlayStation Direct, guys. Have a good one. This has been our state of play. It's like,
And then
again, to each their own, right? To each their own. It's not. It makes sense for who it makes sense for. I'm not somebody who runs to go play Kojima games. So it's just like,
it's Troy Baker the game.
What does this do for me? I mean, but we can't like. I don't hate on Troy Baker, right? I'm like, I think, like I said in the group chat, he's the Chris Sabat of the anime of the game industry. Like,
no,
you can't hate on Chris Sabat because he can play Vegeta, Piccolo, All Might, Zoro, etc. But you're just like, it would be nice if somebody else. Yeah, it would be nice if somebody else was voicing these characters. Would be nice. Yeah. But you know what's funny is like she's always a distinctly different character with the same facial model, which I think is hilarious. It's like Troy Baker is a different tweet, voice on a different character. It's
the same design.
It's the same character email. Model.
Because like she was in Star Wars, she was in Suicide Squad, and she was in two.
They just like, emailed the design.
Same design.
Airdrop.
They just see each other. Yeah, airdropping rigs over to other studios. Hey, we still have our motion capture software from when she did Jedi Survivor. You guys can have it. Knock yourselves out.
She gonna be in Detroit. Detroit, what's it called? Detroit Become Human 2.
Oh, but she's fire though. So I can't hate. You know, it's like I can't hate on her, but it is a little crazy that she's in so many properties as basically herself. That's a little wild.
The only thing that I would like to see from other state of plays, man, is time for some of those dormant. I wouldn't say that word dormant. These new studios that Sony acquired, I would really like to see what some of them are really pushing forward, man. Because I do feel like, you know, you went to such great heights to develop this master portfolio of studios. And yes, I get it. There are certain of them are for certain regions. Certain of them are for certain technological advances. Some of them are dedicated towards VR, the PC side of portions, catalog for PlayStation. But okay, I'm ready to see what they produce. Like, you know, for example, you acquired Sony Bend. Sony Bend has been quiet since Days Gone. Yeah, Days Gone was a sleeper. You know, people enjoyed the complete version, because I still see gameplay videos of it now. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of like that Last of Us, but not really Last of Us for certain people.
Yeah, it was more like, it's kind of like, it was like, it was a, it was like that first 48 hours to like The Walking Dead of video games. You know what I'm saying? Or like a Shaun, I can't say Shaun of the Dead because it's more of a parody. But yeah, like first 48 to like a Walking Dead of like same template, but a completely different approach to that genre.
Yeah. So it's kind of like, you know, we were ready to see what else people are producing. Cause, I mean, because you already know the Gran Turismo platform, that's the only game that they make.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's going to last the entire console cycle.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe
every cycle,
like a slight spinoff.
Yeah,
because you know that's something that is the definition of a live service game. Because they keep giving you updates. Oh, here's 200 new cars. Enjoy.
But when you're training the NASCAR, what do you say? Well, you don't say like at that point. Like, what can I say? You training NASCAR drivers?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll deal with it.
I do feel like it is time for. Not Insomniac. Who's the other one?
Sucker Punch.
Sucker
to do something. Punch, I do.
Yeah.
My goodness.
Ghost has run its course. Like, yeah, the multiplayer is doing fine, so that's a good placeholder for people. But I am interested to hear what's going on.
Yeah, what y'all doing?
Naughty Dog is Naughty Dog. Media Molecule. They've been quiet for a while. Quantum Dream, are they acquired by Sony? Because I know they're working on a Star Wars game.
I don't know if there is. They might be, because they've only seen the name Sony game. I don't know if it's Star Wars game.
That real time strategy game, not strategy game, but the quick time event movie.
No, I think it's called Star Wars Eclipse or something like that. But they released like one trailer the last E3.
Star Wars, so. The movie game.
That's all they released. Yeah. Quick time events, the game. Hey,
I can't do it, man.
I like those type of games.
Like Azura's Wrath, I was punching the screen.
I do. I know. No, I'm saying but I like it knowing that it's not for everybody. Like, I'm not going to sit there and be like, no, yeah. Jordan, you just don't understand.
Become Human is the most hilarious.
I get it.
I'm just watching people like, yo, man, what happens if I punch this kid in the face as a robot? You know what I'm saying? Like, okay, I guess.
No, I get it. It's not for everybody. But I enjoy those type of games. But I think for me, from State of Plays, I'm tired of it being so unpredictable. In that sense of like, even if I'm not, you know, again, raised on Kojima, maybe I can appreciate it more if I know that's what's coming. Hey, we're going to be having a Kojima panel at some time during the show. That at least lets me know, okay, Spider-Man ain't coming. Final Fantasy ain't coming. As opposed to, man, this trailer's been going on for some time now. Huh. They said 45 minutes. This is about minute 35. We 4 minutes into this trailer. What could be less? And it's like, and here's another look at what Kojima's doing for us. It's like, so no Spider-Man.
You thought wrong when you saw the Columbia Pictures logo.
You know, like, But I think, fellas, this pretty much wraps up our overall games pod. Thank y'all all so much for listening and tuning in to us. We will be dropping another pod shortly thereafter with a little bit more of an anime focused subject matter. But for now, this has been the Gamer Podcast. I am Antonius the Gamer. This is Super SSS Rank, Mikkel Smith. And thank you guys for tuning in to another episode. Have a good one.